going straight to questions on the boards, or are there any they're going to say
straight,
anything?
Straight to questions.
Good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting in 2014 of the Health and Sport Committee. As usual at this point, I would ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other wireless devices, as you know, can disturb the flow of the meeting and sometimes interfere with the sound system. Although the caveat to that, of course, is that some members and officials here are using such devices, tablets, etc., instead of hard copies of their papers. I have this morning a number of apologies, Colin Kerr, Rhoda Grant and Annette Millen. And I welcome Dennis Robertson as the SNP substitute, once again standing in for Dennis Kerr. Our first item on the agenda today is a decision on whether to take item five in private. Item private, as you know, is the work programme which is normally taken in private. But can I have the committee's agreement to take item five in private?
Yes.
Thanks very much. We now move to agenda item number two, which is NHS Board's budget scrutiny. And today we're taking evidence from a number of territorial NHS boards. And can I welcome to the committee Carol Gillie, Director of Finance, NHS Borders, Alan Gray, Director of Finance, NHS Grampian, and Paul James, Executive Director and Director of Finance, NHS Glasgow and Clyde, and last but not least, Gerry O'Brien, Director of Finance, NHS Orkney. Welcome to you all and this morning, and there's a number of questions that the committee are interested in, and can I kick off with the question in and around earmark funding. We think it may be useful to explore this area. We picked up on a couple of things, like, you know, in terms of Orkney, this is we understand particular relevance, which is has 35% of your total allocation as earmarked funds, which we might have expected to be reflected by Shetland and Western Isles. The differences there that we would appreciate some explanation about the high proportion of earmarked funds in Orkney as compared to Shetlands and Western Isles, and it's just an area that you may wish to enlighten us about this morning. Thanks. Yes, thanks, Mr. O'Brien.
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener. Yeah, I mean, I think the level of earmarked funding, I'm not aware fully of the details between Shetland and Western Isles and myself, but certainly for NHS Orkney, we do have a proportionately high level of earmarked funding, and there's probably a few issues in there. We receive our Highlands and Islands Travel Scheme funding, just over £2 million, which is an earmarked funding, and this is all in the context against a core revenue allocation of just under £36 million. So the proportions are quite high. Obviously, there's our primary medical services allocation, which again is just over £4 million, which again makes a significant contribution to that. And then we have a few other smaller allocations, total about £1 million for our alcohol and drug partnership, our e-health money, where we receive just between those two about £1 million. So all of that adds up to quite a significant proportion of our total funding. In just understanding the question, I don't fully understand what we would receive differently from NHS Shetland and Western Isles, and I can just assume it must be in relation to the proportionate share against their core RRL. The earmark funding in itself doesn't present any problems for NHS Orkney, because the funding comes down for very specific topics, and that's where we put it into. So although it's proportionately high, and it's proportionately high against the other territorial boards, it really doesn't present any issue at all, and in many ways actually helps us with the planning, because it's certainly in relation to e-health. We work very closely with our e-health colleagues and Scottish Government colleagues in relation to Highlands and Islands Travel Scheme, so we were actually able to plan on the earmarked funding coming through on a fairly consistent basis. So yes, I accept that proportionally I think we're probably the highest in NHS Scotland, but I think it's probably relative. It's that relative position to our RRL position of just over, just under 36 million. Sorry.
Yeah, yes.
I can give you some background.
Thank you.
Background information from Borders. Our earmarked funding is about 24 million, which is 12%, so a much lower percentage than Gerry. But within that 24 million, the biggest element is just over 15 million for GMS contract, which is the nationally agreed contract we have with the GPs, independent providers. And then the other largest element within that 24 million is 3 million for our salaried dentist service. So we employ dentists to do general dental practitioner work. So if you take those two allocations together, 18 million out of that 24 is really for a very specific purpose. In addition, the final 6 million is some of the issues that Gerry picked up around about drug and alcohol. And another big element is e-health on how we actually take information technology forward within Borders. So you can see, once you take the larger elements out, the amount of funding round about earmarked is quite small and for specific projects.
Anyone else? Earmarked funding, no? Yeah. Yes, Mr.
Can I just James? Say, well, I think that the purposes of the earmarked funding have already been mentioned by colleagues, but I think that the point to make, although it's obviously much lower as a percentage in Glasgow, it's for the same sorts of purposes that have already been mentioned to the committee. But I think the benefit of having earmarked funding is that it helps to achieve specific objectives, and that's, I think, what the key of all of this is. So, in other words, the funding is given for something and it's used for that purpose. So the same is true in Glasgow, although obviously the percentages are very different.
Bob?
Yeah, it's on another matter, convener, so I don't know if unless anyone's got a supplementary on this one specifically. Is that okay? Yeah. Thank you.
Would you like to follow up on that, Dennis? Yeah, I think we're all keen then and then take Bob.
Sure.
I'll take any supplementary to follow up. Dennis Robson, please.
Hey, thank you, convener. Perhaps maybe start with Orkney. And you'll, one of the things you mentioned was the e-funding in terms. I wonder, are you looking at a reduction eventually then in your travel costs? Because if consultations are going to be done through, for instance, a Skype-type system from consultants, and you're going to be looking at that, surely then your travel costs will diminish quite considerably, because patients won't be, for instance, going to Aberdeen for specialists, and the consultants won't be travelling to Orkney either. So do you anticipate a reduction eventually in the costs of patients and of consultants having to travel to Orkney?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's absolutely one of our planning assumptions, and it's one of the areas we've been working very closely with our Scottish Government colleagues in, is in terms of the Highlands and Islands travel, for the exact reason you do. We're doing a lot of work to repatriate services to Orkney, principally from Grampian. And we are certainly planning on the basis of we will be able to reinvest that money locally in services rather than spending it on airfares. So we'd certainly be looking at a reduction in travel costs and a reinvestment locally. I think the other aspect to that as well, although the principal changes or maybe the changes of the biggest magnitude will be between ourselves and Grampian eventually, what we're also spending a lot of time on, and this is where we're really doing a lot of our e-health work, is we're looking at all of our islands as well, because what we're trying to do as well is not to have people travelling, say, from North Ronaldsay or Westry into mainland Kirkwall for an outpatient appointment there. So we're spending quite a lot of our e-health money last year and this year and moving forward, and actually making sure the facilities are available on island. So it's I'm totally expecting a reduction in travel off from mainland Orkney onto mainland Scotland, but I'm also looking on a reduction of travel time from patients coming in from the Isles as well. So I think all of the aspects that you've picked up are certainly true, yes.
I mean, that's travel plus accommodation.
All of it. Yeah.
In fact, you've actually got the return of better health care and well-being in terms of the patients. Do you anticipate the cost that you'll eventually save? And I mean, surely you've got a projection there.
Well, what we're looking at a return journey to. I mean, if you use a good example at the moment, we are in the process later this summer. Our on island CT scanner will go live, and we're probably looking at a gross revenue commitment on that after we bought the scanner and kitted out the building. Of about £400,000 a year. Now, we estimate from the scans which we'll be able to do on island, because we still won't be able to do everything on island, that we'll be able to save about £150,000 a year of that from reduced travelling time for patients who are currently going down to Aberdeen for scanning. So although there'll still be a net investment, we're probably looking at a gross investment of about £400,000 coming down to a net investment of about £250,000. And what we're tending to do is look at it on a service by service basis. And one of the areas, as we've made our move into a consultant-led model for medicine, obstetrics and gynaecology on island, is we're actually looking to use the skills that we now have on island from those our medical colleagues, and actually looking at specific services. So we don't have an overall projection. We're really looking at it as service by service and almost a specialty by specialty. But it would certainly be a correct assumption that we're anticipating a shift from spending money on travel, accommodation and lots of downtime that way to actually providing services directly on island and taking the whole patient experience and improving the whole patient experience.
There are clear advantages to us, Dennis, in terms of the release of consultant time. There's quite a capacity of consultant time required to go up, do the sessions in Orkney and come back down. So we see that's been advantageous to us in terms of releasing clinical capacity to do more work within the kind of Grampian and North area. The other advantage really from a clinical person-centred perspective is that we're able to hold these consultations hopefully over time with not only the patient themselves, but also the patient and their GP. The GP is an important part of the continuous care of patients, particularly in remote locations, Orkney and remote locations in Grampian. The ability for a consultant to have that consultation with the patient and the GP really has some really long-term clinical advantages in terms of helping that person stay closer to home and well for longer. So we see the cost advantages, but in the longer term, there are real clinical and patient care advantages over taking on that model. It prevents people from travelling, even within the mainland. Many people make long journeys for very, very short appointments and very little clinical benefit.
It's a difficult moment to sort of measure cost saving in terms of patient well-being in terms of the long term. However, are you projecting in Grampian a cost saving as well, not just in consultancy time, but in terms of the provision you make within Grampian to some of your remote and rural areas, and using the same E-type health that you're projecting, say, for Orkney and using your consultants in that way?
The biggest saving we see is avoiding costs rather than cost saving in itself. We've got a projected.
But surely there must be a cost saving. I know you're going to avoid, but there must be an eventual cost saving.
Well, hopefully, we will have to identify a number of cost savings as part of our annual budget. So we'd hope there will be an element of cost saving, but clearly part of that is also avoiding the future costs in terms of increased activity. We face a rising population in Grampian. That's our biggest single challenge. In addition to having to make the savings, we're having to manage a population growth that over the next 10 to 15 years we'll certainly see a rise in the population, both of working age and also those post-retirement. So okay. I think we do have to be minded to both. One is making sure we're able to provide the quality of care within the resource we've got. People then agree with you, we do have to find ways of making cost savings, and this will be one avenue where we can make the system more efficient and lose capacity. There's also a challenge of actually workforce will be as much a limiting factor as finance and be able to recruit and retain very specialist staff. So this will be a way of using that scarce resource in a much more efficient way to benefit a greater number of people.
Thank you. Thank you.
The question that popped out of my head when Dennis was pursuing that line is that there was a significant investment of £400,000 in the new scanner, which obviously will benefit the people in Orkney and you know, the patient experience. But it seemed, with the relationship with Grampian, that it was going to free up resources and efficiency. Did you make a contribution to the...
No, we
is there any sharing of the budget or investment for change that benefits both Grampian and Orkney?
Yeah, we work very close with Orkney in terms of the way that
close enough to share budgets. Or
well, not
that close.
We don't share budgets, but in terms of actually the way we cost the services that we provide to Orkney, we do that an open basis with them. Uh-huh. And in fact, we don't recover the full cost of the service that we provide to Orkney. So in many ways, Grampian do carry part of the burden of providing the service to both Orkney and to Shetland health boards. But that's part of our annual budget decision-making process. We work very closely with Gerry and an executive team in Orkney in terms of helping with the future redesign of the service. So we're very much part of that journey, and we do make a contribution both in terms of, you know, our thinking and input into that. But I do think in a budgetary sense, we do work very closely with both the island boards to make sure that we can provide our resources in the most efficient way, but also on a basis that's affordable to both health boards.
Gil.
It's in a similar vein, but I think it relates to financial matters per se, but I'm just wanting to understand the corroboration that goes on. When the scanner is up and running, what happens? Where does the personnel come from? Does it come from resources in Grampian, or is it new resources?
Actually, a bit of both. We're at the moment undergoing a recruitment exercise for additional radiographers on island, and we will recruit those. We've already recruited one of the three that we need, and we've got another two adverts out at the moment. So they are new resource on island. But in terms of the actual reading of the results, that will be undertaken by the consultant radiology staff in Grampian,
right,
exactly as it is at the moment. So in terms of the reading of the scan, it's actually the location of it happening, it will change, and it just goes, it uses the e-health technology and goes down the line to Grampian and is ready exactly. And that's one of the good examples of where Grampian and Orkney do work together. So there has been recognition by the radiology staff within Grampian that some of the scans which will happen on Orkney are currently happening in Grampian. Obviously, as we open up our new scanner on island, we are fully anticipating that the number of overall scans will increase. But there's a recognition within Grampian that there will be some freeing up of radiology times, although we're having discussions about a full reporting service. It's not the full cost of a new reporting service. So though there's not actually been a physical transfer of cash, it's not a full reporting service. So I think I would totally support Alan's point that I think the development of services on Orkney, and this is one of the key elements for us, it's we have to develop services on Orkney, and we're very keen to repatriate services to Orkney, but it's services which are appropriate and safe to do so, but it's also very mindful of services and the impact that then that has us, because there's always going to be a residual left in Grampian which we need to send to Grampian, because there's always going to be a level that we can do, we cannot go above in Orkney because we have no ITU facilities or so forth on island. So patients who may well need ITU services are always going to have to go to Grampian. So there really is quite a dependency. I think is probably a good way of saying that there is a dependency from Orkney on Grampian. So it demands that very close working relationship with NHS Grampian.
Well, the relationships anyway, particularly when you come to Glasgow, we provide services for, you know, about how health boards are working and providing services and what progress could be made there. Bob, Dennis, I was going to bring Bob in just to move it along a wee bit.
Yeah, sure. Okay, thanks, convener. I want to ask a little bit about budgets in relation to prescribing with GPs and in hospitals, not just the price assumptions, but the volume assumptions that's been provided by to the committee. Now, do have a little bit of context to it, and I'm sure there's been good work going on across a number of health boards, but I do recall when I sat in the Public Audit Committee, a report particularly praising a lot of work done in Greater Glasgow and Clyde in relation to dealing with polypharmacy and most appropriate medications and some real, not just cost efficiencies, but also care improvements for individual patients, so therefore constituents of mine. I'm sure there's been good work elsewhere, but when we see differences in figures, we want to ask questions why they exist. So, for example, I'm looking at the table in front of me that shows a cost assumption for 1450 of a 1% increase in Greater Glasgow and Clyde in relation to the prescribing budget, but it's 2.1% in Borders. But the most dramatic figure that jumps out at me is a 16.8% predicted increase in the hospital prescribing budget in Grampian, which is a dramatic outlier. That might just be the way it's accounted for, and some more explanation on that would be good. But the general theme I'm trying to get to behind these numbers is, apart from that outlying figure, which I think needs some closer attention, is, for example, Greater Glasgow and Clyde, having done some good work already, convener, their baselines, therefore, are new baselines from which you move on from. So dramatic savings cease to flow from that. They become modest savings for a far more efficient baseline. I'm just wondering, between the four health boards we have present, which of you feel you've squeezed as much as possible in terms of polypharmacy and best pharmaceutical advice for patients, where there's still savings to be made, and how you arrive at these cost assumptions. So not that focused, convener, but I think we have to get beneath some of these figures.
In terms of the 16%, if I can maybe address that first. The majority of our spend, predicted spend increases in largely acute sectors opposed to the primary care prescribing budget. And that's for a number of factors. It's largely around the four main services, cancer, so dermatology, I think ophthalmology, the rate of increase is largely due to the population activity increase within Grampian, and also the fact that we expect these drugs to be applied to new indications, so new clinical indications over the next year. So part of the reason that we've increased our budgetary spend in acute is largely the fact that underlying activity growth that we're experiencing in Grampian, it's largely linked to the population growth. It's largely linked to the fact that in terms of cancer services, we're seeing a higher increase in the number of patients who can take fairly aggressive forms of cancer treatment. In Grampian, we've got the benefit of a relatively healthy population. So in terms of cancer treatments, quite a lot of our patients can go through second, third and fourth line cancer care costs. So cancer care is a big part of the increase, and maybe that explains part of the reason that we are different from, say, Glasgow, or some of the other boards. In terms of the GP prescribing budget, I think we're probably more in line with other boards in terms of assumptions around volume. And to ask you a question on polypharmacy, we're probably just at the start of the journey there. That's looking at largely patients who've got multiple medications. We already work very closely through. We've got, within each of our community health partnerships, we have an aligned pharmacist whose primary role is to work with... It's primary role to work very closely with the GP practices, identifying where there's variations in practice, where there's variation in prescribing, to try and work with them to try and eliminate that and to make sure that we're making best use of the prescribing budget.
You know, I know Mr. James wants in, but there's a very specific point on Grampian, if we could follow that through.
Please do that.
So the good bit, first of all, of course, is that means there's additional efficiencies to be saved by Grampian that you're planning ahead on, so that's good that you've put that on the record. You're starting the journey, perhaps Greater Glasgow and Clyde started 2 or 3 years earlier, and we'll hear more about that in a second. But you did mention that threefold increase in the pricing budget in hospitals, and you mentioned treatment of cancers, I think ophthalmology, and you mentioned a third one. Actually, don't worry about that too much. It's just, I don't see why that would be specific to Grampian as opposed to any other health board. And in relation to new indications for treatment of cancers and other conditions, that would befall, that's a good thing incidentally, but that would befall every health board, not just Grampian. So I'm still struggling to understand where the threefold increase from Grampian comes from. And I'm not trying to be awkward, but when we get an answer that doesn't seem to make sense to the committee, it's reasonable to come back. So could you maybe try again on that one? Is there something specific to Grampian in relation to cancer and ophthalmology and new indications that's specific to Grampian and not to other health boards?
I don't have sight in terms of the assumptions that other boards have made. The way it works in Grampian is we take advice from our medicines committee, so it's not a financial decision. This is based on advice given to us by our pharmacy specialists and our clinicians within the hospital. And I have to say that on past record, their predictions have been relatively close to predicting, particularly around the acute budget, to actually what happens in terms of the underlying change or in terms of the prescribing practice within the hospital and also the cost of the prescriptions that we issue.
I come back on that. Still none the wiser on why Grampian would be different than any other health board. Perhaps that's something, if not just now, you could certainly come back to the committee in writing in relation to, because I imagine that you'd be very aware if there was a dramatically higher prevalence rates of cancer in Grampian than other health boards, or there was a much more significant demand for the treatment of certain conditions in Grampian than other health boards. I don't quite get that, but if you could contact maybe the committee in writing with more information, that would be good. Convener, I apologise. I know Mr. James wanted in.
Yeah, I think we are looking from a response. And Bob, I think you also asked the question about, and Mr. Gray responded to it, about previous assumptions being very close to being correct, and you're satisfied that the process you're going through is a robust one, and maybe if others could comment on that anyway. But Mr. James.
If I could just, I don't want to revisit the evidence I gave last year to the committee, but for us in our forecasts, the time of major off-patent savings is coming to an end. And so in our 14-15 plan, we have not taken account of the sort of credit that we were able to take account of last year, and I think it's important to recognise that. If I could deal separately with GP prescribing and then acute, in terms of GP prescribing, I think your first point is correct in the sense that to some extent we're now reaching a point where we feel that in terms of our move towards generic prescribing rather than branded prescribing, which has been one of the things that's underpinned some of the savings we've achieved in Glasgow, that probably we're reaching saturation point on that, and that it will be difficult for us to continue to see major savings in GP prescribing because that's already been done, tick, that's in the past. However, there are some new drugs that always come on, and they will be branded drugs, and there will always be the opportunity in the future to switch to generics when those opportunities arise. And obviously that's a clinical decision, that's not a financial decision. I think it's important to make that point. So I don't see the complete end of savings in GP prescribing land, but I think the end of the large savings that we had last year in 13-14, that I don't see that recurring in the near future. I think if we look at other boards, and just to sort of comment on your point, it's fair to say that there is still quite a wide variation in GP prescribing practice. Even within Glasgow, we see that variation. So I think that it's fair to say that through peer group reviews and informing GPs about the way that their colleagues are prescribing, there is always the potential to still further improve. And that's a very active piece of work in Glasgow and will continue. And I think that is something that other boards can also take advantage of. And therefore, I would see that the variation that will exist not just in Glasgow but also around Scotland does give some opportunities in some other boards. And I think you're right to highlight that as something that the committee might be interested in. If we look at the drugs in GP prescribing area, there is a new drug called apixaban, which is an anticoagulant, which is going to incur some significant cost for us, and that's part of our financial plan moving forward. That's to some extent a substitute for what we thought would be a big pressure, a drug called dabigatran. But that was the uptake of dabigatran was not as great as we had expected, because I think there were some sort of clinical issues with it. I mean, I'm not a clinician, so it's not appropriate for me to comment really, but there were clinical issues. So for that reason, it was not as widely prescribed as we had once thought. But I think apixaban is thought to be free of those issues and therefore may well be prescribed more widely in the future. So we've built that pressure into our plan. If we look at acute prescribing, I do think it's fair to say that that's where, for me, the largest pressure is beginning to occur. And the points that Alan made, I think, are right. I don't obviously know his figures, but I think, in principle, we're seeing much larger percentage rises in the acute medicines bill than we are in the primary care medicines bill. And I don't know whether that trend will continue, but certainly we've put significant funds into acute prescribing in the last few years, and that continues. There is a particular drug, which is my current hobby horse, which is one called sofosbuvir, which is a newly approved drug for hepatitis C, and which is immensely expensive, and which is not just is not just immensely expensive sort of per patient, as it were, it's simply that there are a large volume of patients as well who suffer from that, potentially suffer from that condition. And Glasgow has a disproportionate share of the patients who suffer from that condition. I think it's something like 17,000 patients out of a Scottish population of 40 to 42,000. So we have roughly 40% of Scottish patients. Now, as it happens, sofosbuvir will not be a drug that will be used for all of those patients because I believe it relates to genotypes, and I'm afraid my scientific knowledge begins to run out at this point. But so, to do with your genetic makeup, so it'll work for some patients and not for others. But what that means is that as we go through treating certain patients each year, we will incur potentially an additional cost of several million pounds. I mean, the exact figures we can debate, but I mean, people have talked about 16, 17 million pounds a year, and it will take us a long time to work through the cohort of patients in Glasgow. So that is an acute pressure, which I just bring to that picture to sort of highlight the fact that we're seeing those sorts of medicines coming through. Now, that I can highlight one medicine, and I can highlight the difficulty that Glasgow will have because we have 40% of Scotland's patients and 25% of its funding. But equally, there will be other medicines in due course. And one of the things we were discussing before this meeting is the extent to which medicines will be around this table, I think, an increasing and a continued area of focus for you, because for us in health boards, we will continue to see expensive, branded medicines hitting our budgets and working out what do we do about that. I don't have a general answer, I'm afraid, to give you a solution for the future, but I do think that's going to be a financial pressure which we will face in Scotland for a long period of time. The only other comment I would make is that I think that in terms of drugs like sofosbuvir, where there is a disproportionate share of patients in one particular health board, we will need to look at the way that we risk share, because it would be inappropriate, I think, for Glasgow to have to suffer all of that cost and not to be able to share that around the rest of Scotland. And I have made that recommendation to Christine, who I think will be giving evidence to the committee later on this morning. So I'm hoping that will be taken forward by chief execs in due course.
Before I call the others and then, and people are going to follow up, I'm going to get a response from all the panellists on this. But could you, address the issue, if you have an issue, with what the committee was extensively involved in, which was the access to new and increased access to new and rare medicines that are coming on the market, and are any of that's working through the system? Is that reflected in the budgets that you have produced and presented?
Yes, I mean, obviously the details of the new medicines fund have not really been made publicly available, or I think even decided upon as yet. So we've made some prudent assumptions within our financial plans about the extent to which drugs such as ivacaftor and some end-of-life medicines and similar drugs will be funded. So we've made some assumptions around that. But I think we can't give a definitive answer on the amount of that will be funded in 14, 15 and 15, 16 because the plans have not yet been finalised.
Patients will benefit from this. There'll be more yeses, thousands more yeses in the system. You estimated what that will cost Glasgow, those thousands?
I'm sorry, we're relating Glasgow's figures to all I've done is I've looked at the expected spend within our drugs budget, and I've made what I hope are some prudent assumptions about the funding that we might receive in relation to some of those drugs.
What would that be?
5.9 million.
5.9. Can I have responses from the others on the Bob's general questions and maybe address the question of access to new medicines? And then we'll let the panel come back, and then, of course, anyone who wants in will get in. Yes, Mr. O'Brien.
Perhaps if I start off with the Orkney position, and I don't want to repeat loss of what Paul and Alan have said. We've got a very similar process. I think for the important thing for me is that we do need to be separating the GP prescribing out from the acute, and it's undoubtedly true, and the figures I can actually talk about for Orkney. I think we're probably in the same place in GP prescribing in terms of what Alan has described for Grampian. I think we've done the work on the generics, and I think we've got to a place there where we're relatively comfortable. There's always room for improvement, but we've got a particular couple of practices now where I think we can do some more work in terms of outlying practices, and we're now engaging with one of our better practice GP practices to actually take that work forward, because we're now going to get into the realms of actually clinical decision making. It's not a volume issue, it's actually understanding why GPs are prescribing, so we're addressing that. I think the bigger issue for us is in terms of our acute sector, and I split that in between perhaps what might come through the hospital and what I might regard as the more specialist drugs, which Paul has spoken about. And just in terms of Orkney, I know within the financial plan for Orkney, I've set aside a 15% uplift in the specialist drugs, which is probably many of the drugs that Alan has spoken about in terms of cancer drugs, and particularly the Hep C drug. And I won't try and say it because Paul can say it better than I do. And we are definitely seeing that. I mean, looking through the Scottish Medicines Consortium's forward look, which came out at the beginning of the calendar year, if you look at the drugs which are mentioned in that, and only taking a few of them, there's a potential cost pressure on Orkney there of just under £300,000, which actually equates to just under 1% of our RL, which is actually quite a massive increase for us. So, similar to Paul, we've taken a view. I've taken a view with my director of pharmacy in terms of what that might look like, and we believe in our overall financial plan in terms of drug spend, I'm probably looking at setting aside an additional £400,000 in 14-15, because that is the rate of increase we're seeing primarily on the acute side of things, and probably more into the specialist. We've got a particular high prevalence of MS on the island, and we're definitely seeing the drug spend on that area picking up or actually steadily increasing. I think in relation to the rare medicines, we are probably fortunate that we've not been impacted on that yet directly. I keep a very close eye on it with our director of pharmacy. So we've had no, go back into the last 18 months, we've had no individual patient treatment requests of having nobody go through the rare medicines fund. So it's an issue for us in terms of if it arises, it could be a big issue. So I've got within my £400,000, I've got a notional sum set aside for that. So I couldn't tell you exactly how much the rare medicines fund might impact on us. We've got the other added complication that probably some of our stuff will go through the Grampian specialist treatments there. So that's another example of where Orkney and Grampian really need to keep very close to each other, because undoubtedly some of the requests that go through Grampian will be for Orkney patients, and we just need to make sure we manage that. So I think our position is very similar to what Alan and Paul have described, but I would certainly support Alan in terms of the growth that I'm seeing in Orkney in terms of those more specialist acute sector drugs.
That's it. With the risk of repeating what my colleagues have said, first of all, if I go to acute drugs, a process is very similar to that described by others, where we have a medicines resource group that does the horizon scanning work to try and identify what the likely new drugs will be and the uptake. One thing I would probably add is that I think what I've put in my return is an uplift to my budget. So therefore, the point I'm trying to make is your baseline might be different insofar as that if you've underspent your budget in the past, obviously you've got that benefit. So potentially that can mean you're requiring a lesser uplift if your baseline is that bit higher. When it comes to the GP prescribing budgets, certainly from the case of Borders, there is much more to be done. And if I'll just give the committee a flavour of what we're planning to do. We have done well on generic prescribing, but there are areas, particularly around about our weighted patient costs, that we are focusing in on. We're looking we've introduced a system in December 2013 called Script Switch, which I think the committee heard about last year, to help GPs pick the most cost-effective drug. We're working with GP colleagues to look at specific areas of drug spend where NHS Borders benchmarks poorly. One area we're looking at this year is respiratory drugs. We've also done, as other boards have, a work on polypharmacy. Which is not just about obviously the cost, but it's about it's good medicine, it's about quality of care, and it is about patient safety. But to date, we've looked at patients who are taking more than 10 drugs and are at high risk of admission to hospital. So you can see that's quite a big basket of drugs. So we've still got quite a lot more to do round about that area. So that's another area we're focusing on this year. There's national therapeutic indicators, and we've used the same principle, implied that in Borders, and looked at where practices on specific drugs look like an outlier, and gone and talked to GPs about that. We've also looked at wastage, which is really about focusing round about the dose we give a patient, the actual use of repeat prescriptions, and actually how a patient stops medication, as well as looking at the use of nutritional products. We've got dietitians in helping us. So in the case of Borders, a lot more work to be done round about GP prescribing, and we're taking that forward over the next year.
If I can maybe just finish off in terms of the four areas I was looking for previously, where there's pressure, I can come back and confirm, is cancer, digestive disorders, ophthalmology and rheumatology, so just for the record. The other thing that I would add to Paul, in terms of ivacaftor, which is a drug for CF, funded through the Rare Medicines Fund, and in Grampian we have a higher instance of patients who require CF treatment, an ivacaftor drug for it's about £2 million is a current annual cost. We've predicted that that will continue to be funded through the Rare Drugs, the Rare Medicines Fund through 14-15. That's the assumption made in the plan. Beyond that, there is an uncertainty as to the future funding for that. We've made an assumption that will have to continue within our financial budget. Within the SMC new drugs, you didn't ask how much was set aside. We've set aside £1 million in 14-15. As we go beyond that, there's a higher degree of uncertainty as to, you know, how that will flow through in future years. But we expect that could go up to between £5 and £10 million. That's the degree of uncertainty we have over the period of the, you know, next 2 to 3 years. So there's a degree of uncertainty there we'll have to build into our budgets. But we're waiting further, as Paul says, we're waiting further information and guidance, and that will further inform the budgets from 15-16 onwards.
Really, really helpful. In terms of benchmarking and rolling out best practice elsewhere, I'm reassured that there's still savings to be made. I know rising costs, but savings within those rising costs. So that's good, convener. In terms of Mr. James talking about prevalence and clusters and of various conditions befalling certain regions of Scotland and others, the risk share scheme, that's interesting. I'm sure that's something the committee might return to, and indeed the new medicines, I'm sure that's something we'll return to as well. However, just one final question, convener, in relation to pressures on acute hospital prescribing. I'm wondering how much work around that can be done further. How much of that is due to prescribing due to unscheduled admissions for older patients? How much of that could be tackled via preventative work within the community? In other words, is some of the ways in dealing with acute prescribing, should we just expect that will increase, that's how it is, or is there work to be done in terms of if you have a smaller cohort of patients in hospital in the first place, because they're not coming through A&E, or they're not having unscheduled care at hospital because social care is stepping in to take the burden. Is there any information about how that could be reduced, or should we just expect that's a significant and increasing part of the prescribing budget? I suspect that it'll be similar across all health boards. Could we maybe if it was one or two replies to that, so because my colleagues will want to come in and ask additional questions, I'm sure.
Is largely on the very specialist drugs, which are really available for very small groups of patients. They're the ones where we're seeing the greatest pressure, I think, if I look back over the last few years, whereas the biggest rises, it's largely through not the volume growth in terms of activity, but largely through the kind of the increasing prevalence of very specialist drugs that do have a benefit, but to a small number of patients. We've seen that with the new SMC drug approval process. Again, very expensive patients, but will have a difference for a very small and select group of patients who have particular cancer conditions or other conditions that can benefit from these drugs. There is no doubt that in terms of the integration of primary and secondary care, there's further work that can be done, and I acknowledge that. That work is ongoing to try and reduce wastage, to try and make sure that people are giving appropriate medication. There's a danger that we can overload patients sometimes with medication. So the polypharmacy is very much geared towards that, to ensure that when patients are given changes in medication, that's reviewed in the context of the entire package of medication that's been given to them, because many of the older patients have multiple conditions and some of the drugs can have counter effects. So the polypharmacy is very much focused on trying to make sure that we're doing the right thing for patients and giving them the right bundle of medication to make sure that they have the best outcome as well as the most effective in terms of prescribing cost.
I just wanted to say I absolutely agree with what Alan has just said, but I'd like to throw in an additional statistic that we recently did an analysis of our medicines and identified that I think it was 80 or 90% of our medicine spend was on chronic conditions. So sort of in answer to your question, although the growth I think is certainly in these areas, there's a big block of spend which is on chronic conditions, which is in both the acute sector and also in GP land. And I think, so your point is right in a sense. If we can address the chronic conditions issue, if we can prevent those conditions, then I think there is significant saving to be had. And I would imagine it's not to be fair, not just the medicines bill, which is being incurred on chronic conditions. I think it's also a lot of the GP bill and the acute bill, which is being spent on chronic conditions as well, and the community bill. So the question is whether, and it's a big question, whether or not real impact can be made in reducing the number of people who have those conditions. And I'm afraid that's one I don't have any meaningful comment to give the committee on, but I think it's something that is worth exploring.
I think I've got a couple of bids. Yes, Richard, and Dennis, you went back in again?
Very briefly, I'm trying to understand. We've got 14 health boards all doing this work with individual practices and all managing their acute budgets. But on the other hand, there are two things. One is, what support are you getting from the centre, the Health Improvement Scotland and JIT, to make sure you don't reinvent wheels? In other words, if Glasgow has had this very successful programme of reducing per capita costs on GP prescribing, which they have, to a level which, given the health problems in Glasgow, you know, is significantly lower than all the other health boards per capita. How much of that information comes out as to how they achieved that, you know, how they set about dealing with it, that prevents you from spending endless time in committee reinventing wheels? Is the Joint Improvement Team or Health Improvement Scotland dealing with it? That's the first question. The second question is, some of the things now we've got, you know, the big difference in Scotland's healthcare system from England is that we've got these managed care networks. So that in cancer, which is one of the growth areas for costs in this in respect of drugs, there are only three managed care networks. So how is that costing working? You know, how do you determine? There's a managed care network in the west of Scotland, for example, which covers Forth Fanny, Lanarkshire, Ayrshire and Arran, Argyll, and a bit of Argyll and Clyde. How is that actually managed in terms of budgeting? Because the expenditure is by the clinician at the Beatson on behalf of patients in Forth Valley and Ayrshire and Arran and Lanarkshire. So how is that actually worked? And is the system we've got one that is sustainable, given that that is going to be one of the big pressure areas?
I can kick off if you like, but I'm not sure I have much to say on the managed care network point. In terms of the role that Health Improvement Scotland play, I'm not very cited on that, but I do have a pharmacy team who provide the support to GPs and do the visits. And that team does have input to other health boards. So I do think there is a level of sharing of best practice and of knowledge. Now, I'm sure there's always room for extending that and improving on that, but it's not something that's completely operating in a silo within Glasgow. So I'd just throw that in, and I think that's worth developing. I think that's something that we've talked Absolutely. About before. In terms of the managed clinical networks, I'm not really sure that I can comment, because I deal, as you will understand, on the budgets that are incurred by the Beatson. So that's where my focus tends to be, and we tend not to set a budget at that sort of MCN level.
Can I just add a little with that? I mean, you have now got satellite units from oncology, and you're going to have a new one in Monklands, for example. Who incurs the budget for the prescribing that is going to be made in Monklands? Is that Lanarkshire, or is that you?
I think in terms of
what operates in Lanarkshire, I think that will be Lanarkshire. I will need to check that, but the majority of the budgets operate through our regional services directorate, which is in our acute division, which is run by Jonathan Best, and so his budgets would be what I would be dealing with.
Right. I mean, I'll come back to it maybe under the NRAC, because I don't think this is properly dealt with under NRAC either. I think that some of this, the central boards of Grampian, Edinburgh and Glasgow, which are the three cancer networks, I'm not sure they're properly funded, and maybe that's a separate discussion that we could come back to us on in writing if there's more information.
Did you want me to comment on the two issues?
Yes.
Certainly when we're talking about prescribing, a lot of our support has come from something called Quest, and I was looking at my notes what exactly Quest stands for, but one of the work streams is round about prescribing. So we use Quest to support us in our programme of work. I should also inform the committee that there are networks across Scotland, whether they are pharmacy networks, medical networks or finance networks, where we actually do share information about successful schemes. On your issue around about MCNs, certainly from Borders, we've very much linked into the SCAN, the Scottish Cancer Area Network, and in the South East, what we do is any new drugs are considered by SCAN for all the boards within that area. They also give us advice at the start of the before the start of the financial year, and give us a forecast of what the likely uptake is linked to the new drugs that are on horizon scanning. So we do work on an area basis. We also they design protocols which individual consultants follow, again right across the whole network. So we are working together in a number of areas. I get a bill for any drugs that because we have the share the care of patients. If a patient is seen in NHS loading, which is normally the case in Borders, loading will bill me for seeing that patient and for any high cost drugs that have been prescribed associated with that individual.
Yes, Robertson.
Yeah, very briefly.
Convener, it was a point that Mr. Gray made earlier on. I think you mentioned that that you're dealing with a growth in population. And you've also mentioned, you touched on the sort of integrated health and social care. Is the growth in population then, are you projecting that growth then needs to be met through your prescribing budgets on the acute side? Because I would have thought actually with the integrated programme that's going on, some of the prescribing and actually have gone down to primary care rather than acute. And I'm also interested within ophthalmology, it seems a very strange one, that Grampians may be different from other health boards. Because, I mean, I can understand, again, the ageing population, and if you're treating wet macular degeneration, for instance, with Lucenta, fine. But are your numbers that different from other health boards?
Taking the last, I guess in terms of that, I'll come back with a formal written response, I think, in that. It's difficult for me to comment just now because I haven't seen other boards and where we compare. But if I could come back to the committee with a written response in respect to the query as to why we are different from other boards in terms of assumptions, I will do that in a way that explains in detail. That was helpful to you. In terms of the integration, I think there's no doubt the integration of services both within the NHS as well as between is the integration of services between NHS and local government over time will assist us in terms of managing the kind of chronic illnesses that are contributing to our cost, not only in prescribing, but in terms of overall health cost. So there's no doubt that we'll be seeking to pursue and continue to pursue different ways of managing that activity growth. There's no doubt about it, we cannot continue to provide the same configuration of services or the same type of services given the population growth that we certainly predict within our own board area. So we have to look at different ways of supporting people, look after long-term conditions and also take preventive measures to make sure that people can live longer at home without need for expensive interventional healthcare.
And how you've actually come to that conclusion?
I don't know what the exact population growth in Grampian will be. I can only base it on the number of developments are coming forward for approval in terms of housing developments, in terms of the buoyant nature of the local economy. So I couldn't honestly say that I know what the population increase. We know from the activity flows through the hospital that in certain specialties we're seeing a certain rise in activity. We're managing that as best we can through our efficiency programmes, looking at productivity. But there is certainly a continuing pressure in terms of both the growth of the working age population in Grampian as well as the elderly population. It's mainly the working age population, that's where we are seeing the greatest growth.
Yeah, thank you. Okay.
It may be opportune then just to pick on, you know, the efficiencies that have been expected over the period, and with notable exceptions. You know, it was around that 3% mark, and there was an expectation that boards in the main, not all, but in the main would achieve. But what is the expectation of efficiency savings for the boards from your discussions with the Scottish Health Department and Scottish Government?
We're expected to achieve 3%.
Still the case.
That's what we are expected to achieve.
Does that apply to Glasgow and others as well?
Yes, it does, yes. That consists of what we would call cash releasing savings and also productivity savings. But yes, absolutely.
Let the efficiency versus cut thing stick to the wall. But I mean, in terms of some of the efficiency savings, boards have reported to us in terms of how they would attempt to achieve these efficiency savings. Glasgow suggested that 65% of its savings would be from services. Grampian expects to achieve considerable efficiency savings through workforce equivalent to 32% of the savings. Borders, large extent through non-clinical support services and estate facilities. Again, Borders, Grampian, Orkneys are talking about some HR and other shared services, drugs and prescribing. Would you like to speak to any of these areas where you've suggested, you know, in Glasgow, how are we going to achieve the 65% of that 3% efficiency from services? What does that mean?
I think it's always difficult to categorise savings, whether you're talking about services or workforce redesign. The majority of our costs are obviously people. And if at the end of the day we're looking to provide 3% savings, some of that, as I say, would be efficiency. So we're looking at a cash releasing target of 1.6% in 14-15. So that equates to 32.9 million for us. And we're getting 18.9 million from our acute division. We're getting 6.5 million from prescribing. We're getting 6 million from our partnerships. And there are some other bits in there, but those are the main numbers. Now, the reality is that of those figures I've just given you, yes, there are reconfigurations, in many cases, reconfigurations of services. So that some are relocating from one area to another to make better use of our existing space and the facilities that we have. Some of them will be due to skill mix redesign, where we're saying we don't need somebody quite as senior as for that role, and we can use somebody more junior. There's a whole mix of complicated things that are done, and we've got tens and tens of different schemes, all of which have these descriptions against them. So I don't think it's easy to say, I don't want to leave an impression that, you know, we're cutting a specific service that we desperately need. The reality is that we have a 6% staff turnover-ish in Glasgow, and if you're looking at a 1.6% cash releasing target, you can see that if you can redesign your workforce, and if you can look at skill mix, and if you can look at relocation, then you have the ability to achieve that without making people redundant. You have the ability to basically not replace some people as they leave, but you're doing that alongside a redesign. So I'm afraid that's that might sound like a woolly answer, but I think that is the truth of the way that it's actually done within Glasgow. If our staff turnover were lower or the figure were higher, it would be more difficult to achieve that. And so, you know, when we get up to sort of 4% cash releasing savings, I think the 6% staff turnover figure would just not work.
I think we are looking as a committee about some of the thinking that takes you to your projections on savings. Mm. I mean, I can see the New Southern General, the collocation of coming out of old buildings from the sick kids or relocation down there. I can see, Victoria, you know, these yeah. are. So, the New Southern General, what you've massive investment, what savings do you expect back from that in terms of the wider services in Glasgow Clyde, which is a bigger one rather than the non-replacement of whatever, and you know, that would achieve some thousands of pounds.
The business case for the new hospital was written several years ago and anticipated some very significant savings coming out to cover also some of the capital charges that will of course occur on the new hospital when it's finally handed over. In our 14-15 plan, we do not have any major assumptions for the new hospital, because the new hospital will not be handed over to us until the end of January, and then there's a commissioning period and there's the transfer of patients. So really the major impacts of the new hospital will be in 15-16, not in 14-15. So in my current plan, you will not see much in relation to the new hospital at all.
Well, the business plan is no longer valid. It anticipated a number of... You suggested that was a historical document. I may have picked you up wrong.
Sorry,
to clarify.
Yeah.
But the business plan assumed a number of savings. Do they still stand or not?
I think the business plan would need to be revisited now, because some of the savings that were anticipated when the plan was originally written, we have since that time reconfigured services. So Glasgow doesn't look the same as it did when the original business plan was written. So I don't think all I'm really trying to say is that savings have been made. Bed numbers have changed, and the whole picture is different from the way that the original business plan looked. But I think the new hospital will deliver on its, you know, on the intention around which it was built. I think that's quite clear. But I don't think, what I'm really trying to say to you is, I don't have any good figures in my 14-15 plan that I can put on the table for you this morning, because what we're really talking about is 15-16 and beyond. With the new hospital, when we close sites such as the Victoria, and you mentioned the sick kids, so those sites will be closed. Services will be centralised in the new hospital, I think, really around, and it will probably be some of the more expensive services that are likely to be centralised in the new hospital, so some of the specialties, so we actually create centres of excellence for Scotland. So I think the whole picture has changed in Glasgow since that original business plan was written. I'm sorry, that's the reality.
Yeah, I would concede that it is difficult, whether it be the prescribing budget or any of the other budgets, that a lot of the presumptions you would like to make are, you know, in terms of prescribing, that's decided by pharmacists, doctors, acute sector, that can drive all of this. I mean, you know, it's just interesting to, you know, to try and get to a point about how robust these projections can be when all of these variables come into play. You know, I don't know how much more. That's leaving politics aside and local campaigns, and good that we all plead guilty to that. But you know, leaving that aside, it must be very difficult to get robust projections and identify areas for efficiencies and savings.
I think that's
within that context.
I think that's fair, but I would say that, you know, the new hospital is delivering on its anticipated budgeted cost in terms of the capital cost, and I think, you know, those projections were made a long time ago, and the contracts were let a long time ago. And the new hospital will be there, almost smack on budget, early next year, and I think that's.
But you mentioned the capital charges; they've increased over the piece, have they?
Well, the capital charges were anticipated when the business case.
And they haven't changed.
No, because we knew what the cost would be. I think quite genuinely that's something of which we are genuinely proud in Glasgow, that we will deliver a hospital and it will be on budget. It won't be massively over budget. In terms of the the future operating costs, as I say, that those really are, I think, a bit more for the future. I think we're looking at 15, 16, 16, 17 before I can really come back to you with some useful information on that.
Okay.
Let me just pick up on the fact that, I mean, it's helpful to acknowledge the fact that the health business is a very complex business. It's quite dynamic. There's continuous changes. I think one of the things from a finance, certainly from my own board's perspective, is what makes it work is the close working relationship we have with the services. So as a finance team, we don't work necessarily nicely. We work very, very closely with the services throughout the year. So setting a budget is part of an ongoing process. That, you know, once we set the budget, we're still working with staff because things change from the 1st of April, 2nd of April, things change throughout the year. So it's the importance of building that relationship such that we're working with staff and services all the time. So staff leave at a post, we're looking at opportunity to redesign through skill mix, through changes. So part of the, we can make predictions or best estimates, but how we deliver them is through the very close relationship we have with staff, clinical staff, non-clinical staff throughout. Mm-hmm. And I've got to say, I'm very proud of, you know, the fact the health service does work very closely together and very well supported by the staff. They understand the fact they've got to operate within the resources that are allocated to the boards. But staff do work very, very closely and come up with some very good and innovative ways, sometimes at a small scale, sometimes larger, to ensure that we can continue to operate and provide the level of service we'd aspire to do so, but within the resources that are available to us.
You're suggesting in Grampian that you achieve considerable efficiency through workforce equivalent to 32% of all savings. So that's a difficult environment. You're not a clinician. You deal with figures.
Indeed.
So how many people are how many people do you need to move along, shift along, reconfigure to get your 32% of your total savings out of that? Yeah, must be a figure somewhere.
Yeah, but remember back to what Paul says, we have a turnover of staff every single year. So as we go through because some of that, remember, that's not all that savings. Some of that's efficiency. Some of that's money we'll put back into the system. So the difference between the 3%...
I'm not suggesting you won't put it back into the system. We've left that aside.
Indeed.
Whether it goes back into the system, because that would take us all morning. We probably will be, cuts versus efficiencies where it goes back into the system. But you've presented a budget that says that workforce equivalent to 32% of your savings. What does that mean in terms of how many people work for Grampian now and many people will work for Grampian at the end of the year? Is that how many jobs will go to meet that saving?
But in terms of, we employ 16,000 staff. We have a turnover between 6 and 10%, depending on which year. So there's about 1,000 staff will churn through our system every year. So we look to ensure that we can... Some of that's not necessarily loss of jobs. It could be a change in the skill mix. In terms of using specialty doctors opposed to consultants, using a different grade of staff to deliver the service. So not all of it's a loss of staff. You know, I'm very keen that we maintain the staff numbers as best we can.
But there's a turnover of 1,000 a year. Not all of those will be replaced.
Not all of them. That's correct.
So how many will not be replaced?
Well, I don't. I can't give you that number because I don't have that number to hand in terms of
your budget.
That's the budget. I haven't set a number of posts that require to deliver that. We'll have to work through our plan throughout the year to ensure that we do deliver that level of savings. I don't know how many staff are going to change. I don't know where they're going to change, but we know there will be changes in our workforce throughout the year. So as these changes happen, we look to then redesign the services that are affected by the change in staff or where there's a vacancy. So I can't tell you for exactly how many and what services. But
your budget doesn't work unless there's less.
Correct. Well, unless there's less of something. It could be less staff, it could be less prescribing budget, it could be less in terms of supplies and services.
The important point, I'll let my colleagues, and the important point is for us, I think, when these figures are presented, how did you arrive at that and how robust they are? What sort of thinking, what sort of buy-in do we have with these partnerships? I mean, we all know that that in our world and everybody else's world, it's easy to sit down and discuss these things in the journal. It's much more difficult to get people to accept the reality of that decision and the delivery of that programme, whether it be hospital beds, whether it be a number of clinicians, a number of nurses, or whatever. But budgets are being presented with savings on them that require less people. I don't know if it helps by, an evidence here that we feel unable to say that out loud. You know, when it's in the budget. It's either in the budget or it's not.
Yeah, well, the way the budget's set, it's not set by finance, it's set with our services. So in terms of the budget setting process we go through each year, we have a very detailed exercise where we go through with each service what the budget allocation is likely to be versus the budget, the cost of the service, and there will be a gap each year, and we require the services to come up with plans. We review these with them, both as a finance director, as an executive team, to make sure that these are deliverable. They're underpinned by plans that can be achieved. And we review and challenge all that as part of the budget setting process. When we come up with the numbers here, these have not been written by the finance team in isolation of discussions with services. So there's a very detailed process that sits behind this.
You give me great confidence that all that discussion and hard decision making is going to be, you can't give me a number this morning. It's either real or it's not.
Yeah, but yeah.
Maybe I could come in and describe the process in Borders just to give you a flavour of how we arrived at what I call efficiency programme. The numbers you've got in front of you, that's made up about, in the case of Borders, about 30 different projects. So it's not just one project, there's lots of little projects. And how we identify those projects is we look at the national programmes, I've mentioned that already, around about Quest. We benchmark our services and look where there's potential room for improvement there. We work both at a regional and national level, looking at opportunities. We try and make increased use of technology. And we also engage, as Alan said, with our staff, patients and services. So as a result of all of that engagement, we do identify individual projects. Each project is actually approved by something we call the Clinical Strategy Group, which is made up of clinicians, managers and partnerships. We get buy-in to the individual schemes. Obviously, there are always risks associated with each of these schemes, and in our returns, we put a risk rating associated with those. Just to pick up for Borders, some that you mentioned particularly, is we have put a focus round about estates rationalisation, and we've set ourselves a challenge and target of reducing our estate by 20%. And that's partially linked to some of the challenges we face round about capital, but also trying to reduce our revenue running costs. So to take that forward, we did a space utilisation exercise and we looked at our underutilised accommodation. We've relocated service and linked accommodation to actually working practices. So if you were a community-based service, you needed less accommodation than if you were an office-based service. The other one you picked up was around about non-clinical services. And again, we set our non-clinical services, our backroom services, a 20% challenge, where we've looked to ask them to increasingly use technology to streamline their processes and use functionality of systems. So again, as a result, reduce costs associated with some of our non-clinical services. So that did give you a flavour and how we actually get that buy-in to our individual projects.
Yep, thank you, Convener. I think we go through a very similar process in Orkney, and I mean, I think if to address the point about staffing numbers, if you looked at our workforce plan, the staffing numbers for NHS Orkney will be broadly the same in March 15 as they are today. But actually, if you delve down into that, what you'll actually see is quite a few changes in the composition of those staffing numbers. So, for instance, we are, as we were speaking about earlier, we are recruiting additional radiographers to man our CT scanner. We are recruiting additional nurses for our outreach service within the acute sector, and we are increasing some more of our medical workforce. So all of those areas will go up. So given that we're remaining broadly static, other areas must come down, and that's... And that's the way it will be. So part of our drive in looking at what we call our shared services, a really good example of that is we used to have a laboratory manager on island who's now left us, and we've now went into an arrangement with Shetland where we now share the laboratory manager and we share the quality manager. So in rough headcount, I'm down one, but I have the exact same service coming into the laboratory, and I actually have an increased service in terms of quality management in there. A big piece of work for this year is we're looking at all of our estates and facilities staff, and by the facility staff I probably mean the domestics, the porters, the catering staff. So we are looking at there in conjunction with our HR colleagues, and we're just about to engage with our area partnership colleagues in terms of this is probably in preparation for the new hospital coming along in 4 years' time. where we're moving towards a generic worker. So no longer will we have a dedicated porter and a dedicated domestic and dedicated estate staff. We'll be looking for a generic worker who can actually swap between all three of those areas. What that will allow us to do, and again, what you would look at in a rough headcount, is we will probably end up with maybe five or six less. At the moment, we've got 8 porters, 10 in estate staff, and about 28 in domestics. I'll probably end up 5 or 6 less than that at the end of that period. But exactly as Alan has said, that will be achieved by the means of turnover. As people leave the system, we won't replace them. What that allows us to do then is do the reinvestment in other areas. We've got a whole range of other services areas where we're looking at as well. And we're looking at, we're using the national workforce tools to make sure that our staffing levels are appropriate in all of our clinical areas. Where we're doing a bit of work this year is, and where we're probably a bit behind the times in terms of, and it goes linked to technology, we need to do a lot more work in relation to our rostering systems to make sure we've not got duplication on shifts and overlap on shifts, and that the shifts are actually starting at the optimal time, both for the delivery of the services and from a finance point of view. So that's the process we're going through. Big area for us this year has been the use of locums in going into 14-15, because my financial plan allows for a particular recruitment pattern. The consequence of that is that we will have to use locums to fill the gaps. And obviously a big area for us then is to try and accelerate that recruitment to try and minimise the expenditure on locums. So similar to borders, we probably have about 20, 25 schemes. And just picking up your earlier point, some of those will end up in us not recruiting to posts which we have in the system. But overall, our overall headcount between April 14, April 15 will remain broadly similar, but I say quite a different skill mix then if you actually drill down below it.
That answers the question about Orkney being the only board not planning efficiencies through the workforce. But just in terms of planning efficiencies through the workforce, you know, it's opportunistic. It's not necessarily planning, is it? If so, you know, in terms of if an opportunity comes up because someone's leaving, rather than, you know, seeking opportunity for change in delivery, because you can't go out and say, well, that department there, we would like to change that, we would like to leave people off or whatever. You've no compulsory, you've done the same place.
But for each of those individual projects I referred to, there's a workforce assessment done, and from that we can quantify what the workforce impact is. And as Gerry said, it's not just about reducing your workforce, because across here you've potentially got areas of service development investment. So our workforce plan takes both reductions in staffing linked to efficiency, but also increases in staff linked to service development or service redesign. So you have to bring the two elements together, and our workforce plan does that.
Paul James.
Can I just comment on the point about is it planning or opportunism? I think on the whole it's planning. There will of course be some opportunism, and people leave and people take the opportunity to do some sort of redesign of the workforce. But the vast majority of the PIDs that I've received and the business cases I've received for the savings that I look at talk about things like skill mix changes. They actually are planned skill mix changes. If I look at the new hospital, we've created around 500 jobs with the new hospital. If I look at the investment that we made consciously last year in nursing to reflect planned changes on nursing ratios, we've made an investment in that. So I think there's much more planning than there is opportunism. I don't think it's one or the other, but I do think there are some very significant aspects of planning and some new job creation as well, which I've just given a couple of examples of.
We need to move on, but it was you that suggested that the turnover was the big factor in terms of efficiencies. There's a difference between workforce planning and development, where we're not seeking to achieve any efficiencies, really, as described in the budget, whereas in all of the others, we're attempting to achieve efficiencies through staffing levels, which is...
Sorry, Convener, can I just say, if I misled the committee, I apologise. What I meant to say was that the 6% turnover figure enables us to achieve those planned savings. I didn't mean it drove those savings. In other words, if somebody comes up with an intention to redesign a particular part of our workforce,
then that is achievable without redundancies because we have a staff turnover. That was my point. I apologise if I didn't express it very clearly.
Clarify. I imagine you actually, I've experienced this person at the Beatson where you redesigned the daycare service and it meant that 10 staff were redeployed. So it's actually about, you know, if the opportunity arises with someone leaving, you can actually then try to redeploy staff as part of service design of another service. So, but I think there is a fundamental point, and that is that the whole service in Scotland saw a really quite abrupt decline in the number of nursing posts. It was up at 2,500 at one point, and we were certainly being, you know, expressing quite considerable concern about that reduction in nursing staff. It's now back down to 500. It's really, it's gone down and come up again, and it's quite difficult to see how that was part of a planned operation. It'd be interesting to have your comments on that. I mean, almost every health board showed a significant decline in posts. So these were actual losses in workforce, which seemed to be part of an efficiency drive, a reduction in budgets, which has now been substantially reversed, I'm glad to say. But
sorry, can I just get off? I mean, I don't think I can make, any of us can make much of a useful contribution. I think your observation is correct, that the numbers went down, and the numbers are now, in a sense, going up. But to say it wasn't planned is just not correct, because all of the directors and managers who we engage with as part of our budgetary process have produced these plans. Now, the fact that they've reversed something, I mean, it doesn't necessarily mean that they've actually reintroduced staff in the same place as they had them before. You've made the point that they have... At the Beatson, you gave an example of a service redesign. Now, I think you know, there are lots of those redesigns that go on. Some of them require more staff, some of them require less staff. And, of course, that's put in a context of an overall financial challenge, yes. But I don't think it's fair to say that doesn't mean there's any planning around the place. I think, actually, the majority of my directors and managers would absolutely strongly object to that.
There's optimum planning that you need to make. 2,500 on a voluntary basis. Those nurses who presented you with the opportunity volunteered for redundancy and were paid redundancy and pension packages. Now, it seems a long way round. You can make a virtue out of it now, but they're not necessarily back in the places that we wanted them. But sure, there's a better way of doing it rather than making a lot of people redundant out of one door and another door, and put them in another ward or in the community, which is effectively what's happening.
You're looking at me, Kavita. All I can say, Kavita, is I think that the health service in Scotland clearly is undergoing redesign, and there have been many, many initiatives, some of them large, some of them small, and they involve staffing changes. I honestly don't think you can draw any conclusions about just a lack of planning. I mean, the reality is there are major redesigns going on all over the place. And what you see in our budgets is a small reflection of that. And so I just don't link the two. I mean, I accept that the staff numbers have gone down. I accept that they're going up a bit. Certainly that's my experience.
I mean, it was a 5% reduction. And it's strange to see that very sudden reduction. And then the increase. I mean, I'm delighted with the increase again, and I'm sure they are different posts, but, you know, it does seem strange planning that you actually saved 2,500 nursing salaries 3 years ago, and now, you know, you've actually had to increase it again. I don't follow the planning mechanism that actually got those posts, 2,500 of them, away, and they weren't replaced immediately by other posts in new design services, which is what's now happening.
Not going to get
Bob. Okay.
Aileen, first Aileen, then Bob.
Yeah, thanks. Actually, I think the discussion's probably moved on, because the supplementary that I wanted to ask actually for Alan Gray was around the extent to which Grampian is using the mandatory workforce planning tool to help make sure that you've got, you know, the appropriate staff with the right skill mix in the right place at the right time.
Lead nurses in each of the sectors. to tell us what the predictive tools would tell us in terms of the nursing resource they require to manage the services that they deliver. And clearly, for Grampian, there's a gap between what the workforce tools would say. So what we can do is a second exercise to actually prioritise actually what we'd need in terms of immediate priorities, because a part of the application of the workforce tools is the professional judgment. So we go through an iterative process of review and challenge with each set of nurses with a view to making some changes in nursing workforce over the next year. We're due to meet as a board, I think, sometime at the end of this summer to look at the output of that process and then make some decisions around further investment within a nursing resource informed by the workforce tools. We'll not be able to match the full resource, but certainly working toward a plan over the next few years as we receive further NRAC additional monies to use that as best we can to address gaps to service, one of which is in a nursing resource.
Thank you, actually, convener. The question I did want to now ask was around the preventative spend aspect and the potential savings that you anticipate from the various initiatives and projects that are part of your preventative health programmes. And I'm keen to know more about the extent to which the boards are assessing the potential long-term savings from preventative spend and any modelling work that you are maybe looking to do, perhaps in collaboration with others to help with that assessment and future financial planning, as well as any progress that you're able to try and make in trying to capture the impact and performance of preventative actions. Now, I note from the responses that we received from the boards that we have reported to the committee that appear to be some difficulties in modelling the savings with any degree of precision. And there has been reference to the potential usefulness of national work in this area. I know certainly Borders had mentioned in their response the possibility of using, for example, the Scottish Public Health Network or some other appropriate collaboration. So I'd welcome some comments on that. Please.
We have said in our return that there are not very many savings anticipated in our financial plan for 14-15 from preventative spend. And that's what we said last year. And I think that's what we'd say next year. I think the reality is that we make investments in certain aspects of preventative spend. And I gave the example earlier of sofosbuvir, and we mentioned the Hep C drug, which, I mean, this is a cure, so it's clearly a preventative spend. But do we know the savings that will result from that investment that we're making, and when they will be, when they will occur? I don't think we do, and I don't think we've made any significant attempt to reflect those savings in the plan. Because if I were to put those savings in the plan, I would then have to be saying I could reduce the number of acute beds that I need, or reduce the number of prescriptions that I would expect GPs to issue in the future. And the reality is, I don't expect those things to be reducing in the near term. And that may be because there is a demographic challenge, and it may be that all I'm doing with preventative spend is stemming the growth that I would otherwise find very difficult to handle. So I always struggle with this question. I know the committee likes this question, but that's the reality of our financial plan. And I think we would be, I would certainly be unwise to have reduced my budgets to reflect some savings that are coming in. I think the reality is we see a level of demand. We spend all the money we get meeting that demand, and we'd like some more, please. But you know, to say that we can then just reduce the budgets because we're spending money on sofosbuvir or smoking or something like that, it just doesn't feel true to me sitting around the table. And that's an honest answer to the committee. It may not be what you'd like to hear, but it's an honest answer.
I think I agree with that. I think it's, we recognise the importance of taking preventative actions to help support the prevention of, you know, long-term illnesses and chronic illnesses within the population. It's something we'll certainly have to do if we're going to manage the kind of demographic challenge we face going forward. The challenge we face as financial professionals is equating that to a budget setting process and setting that in context of savings, reduction in budgets, reconfiguration of services. There's no doubt that preventative spend is in preventative actions. We almost want to see preventative measures being an integral part of all health service interactions, so whether it be a GP visit or a hospital visit, actually, and also in our schools, that there is a concerted effort to educate and to assist people to manage their care on a longer term basis. But the reality of that, reflecting that in a budget, is very, very difficult for us to predict. So I expect there's further work that could be done in terms of modelling, in terms of actually what could be achieved over a long period of time. But we're a bit away from that in terms of reflecting that in a five-year plan. So it's an important point. It's an important point we have to address, but it's a significant one for us to address as part of our sort of budget setting process.
Since I mentioned it in my return, I should maybe just come in, but absolutely agree with what my colleagues have said. We do try and measure the success of preventative spend linked to outcomes, which we can measure, which is more about, you know, increased breastfeeding rates and increased immunisation uptakes, those sorts of things. So we do actually know we're having success. And as Alan said, that very much links to a healthier population that will help us potentially deal with the demographic challenge we face. Round about the modelling, which again colleagues have mentioned, it would be supportive if taken forward. Borders really, to be honest, doesn't have the capacity or potentially the skills, but I think there's a real opportunity there to do longer term modelling. Would tell us about outcomes in the longer term, but also might help inform how we actually design our services going forward. You know, the treatments that we have to give based on some of the preventive spends, changing the actual referral patterns in the future. So certainly something I would welcome, but I think needs to be done on a national basis.
Yeah, I probably don't have a lot new to add to what my three colleagues have said. I mean, I think going back to, and Carol mentioned the Quest, the Quality Improvement Efficiency Support Team, I think is the title of it. They have recently established the Health Economics Network as another subset of Quest, and I think all boards have signed up to that. And that's certainly in the discussions I've been having with my Director of Public Health, is where we see we're in the same situation. We don't have the internal capacity or the skills, if I'm being absolutely honest about it, to do the modelling that's required to actually assess the impact that the preventative spend has had. Whenever I relate to Orkney, we have got a particular issue on Orkney in relation to alcohol-related admissions, but we do spend a lot of work through our local drug and alcohol partnership with the third sector and putting a lot of preventative measures in place. But could I sit here today and tell you how many bed days of admissions that has prevented? No, I couldn't. But I think it's somewhere we need to get to just to understand it. But I think I would totally agree with Paul, even if I could then come up with a figure, whether it be 100 days, 200 days, 300 days, I don't think that would ever lead me to the point where I would be saying I now can take a bed out of the acute system, because what we'd actually be saying, well, that would be replaced. It would give us the opportunity to replace that bed, which is getting used for that particular treatment at the moment, with another treatment. But I think the important point is, exactly as Carol says, we've got to get to a point where we just really understand all these flows that are going through the system. But from a purely financial point of view, I don't think we're probably even close to the point where we can actually start planning financially as to what these impacts would have. But it has got to come.
Bob,
In fact, I'll just very briefly come in. I think Aileen might have mopped up slightly in her supplementary. It was in relation to the workforce planning tool and Dr. Simpson's questions in relation to budgets and nursing number trends over the years. It's just to get an assurance that the workforce planning tool, the new emerging workload management tool and the bed management tool, agreed in partnership with unions and government, that they are used and followed, and then the budgets that you then set are underpinned by whatever the outcome of those planning tools are. So rather than looking at having a debate about nursing numbers 3 years ago versus 2 years ago or 1 year ago, what I need to be sure is when you're planning your staff headcount going forward, that they are using those agreed planning tools to inform yourself. Because I agree with you, there will undoubtedly have been planning in previous years, but clearly, in my view, perhaps not careful enough consideration was given through that process, and the new planning tools changes the landscape by which you make future decisions, so clinical decisions, infrastructure decisions, and then the budget decisions that you're responsible for. So do you use these planning tools on an active, ongoing basis, and has it changed how you do your planning?
I can respond on the nursing one, because that's the one we use. my director of nursing uses the planning tools, and I know they continue to come out with newer ones that cover different areas. But we do that exercise on an annual basis, and we build in the results into our LDP. So certainly from the nursing perspective, some of the other ones you mentioned, I think, are just emerging. So I couldn't comment on that at this point in time.
Yeah, I mean, I would agree. We're using the nursing workforce tools on an annual basis, and we have just in the last weeks run the small wards tool. We've got a particular quirk in Orkney because we have neither a medical ward nor a surgical ward, so we actually have a combination of both. So we have to work with that just to decide which one we take of that. But in terms of output from that, that is all taken through our area partnership forum, and that underpins all our budget setting exercises as well.
Can I just agree with my colleagues? I mean, I think that's right. The nursing tool is the one that's more advanced and in current use than the others. And I think, as I mentioned earlier on, we made an investment last year in nursing, and that has continued because of the expectation of nursing ratios and the nursing tools, and that's all under the control of our nursing director, and it does indeed impact on our financial plan.
It's similar on Grampian. Thank you.
Quickly, a couple of issues that are on our horizon, which we have dealt with in the integration of health and social care. The change fund has changed in the integration model. Through the cat among the pigeons. We've caused along. You may or may not heard that they just want to cap your budget a wee bit and take bit of that, because you're not handing over any and sharing that budget. You don't share the vision of delivering these services. I'm acting in the role of causal at this point, see if I can get any reaction from the directors of finance from the health boards. But there is a buy-in right across the board that we need to be delivering more in the community, and there is a frustration maybe expressed very strongly by Cosla about how we're going to make that happen and how we're going to share and get that integration going. Your views? Yes?
We have a meeting in Glasgow of the six council directors of finance, and myself and a few other colleagues. There's a lot of work going on integration, but in relation to finance, I think there is in some councils, I think there is an expectation that there'll be a significant shift of money from the acute sector into the community sector. And I'm not convinced that we know whether that will happen or not yet, because we have to see that things like delayed discharges and the problems around delayed discharges will be solved, because they clog up acute capacity and therefore incur cost. We also have to look at things like the average length of stay within acute to see whether or not that is going to be reduced as a result of shifting people through the system more quickly and then back into the community where they need the appropriate care. So I think we've yet to see whether or not in reality there will be meaningful reductions in acute in cash terms that can then be transferred to the community. I do think what we will see under integration is people taking a look at the community health services and the social care services, which have come from the partner councils and health boards, and seeing whether those can be provided more efficiently on a common basis, which is what integration helps achieve. So I think there are three parts to that equation. There's the acute bit, there's the community health bit, and there's the social care bit. And I think by putting the community health bit and the social care bit under one chief officer in one HSCP, we can expect to see redesigns coming through in future years. So I think that's something that we probably will see happening. But I think, just to come back to the point I made earlier about the shift in the demographics, the reality is that hits all three parts of that equation. It hits community health, it hits social care, and it hits the acute sector. And if we're saying that we expect to see increasing numbers of people living longer and therefore requiring community health services and social care and acute, I'm not sure that we're yet clear that one part is going to be substantially reduced in order to to shift the funding around. I know that's the agenda, part of the agenda, but I think that merely to stem the increase in acute would be a real achievement. And I think for the health and social care partnerships to take their responsibilities in terms of delayed discharges in particular and make sure that we're actually able to get people into the community in the right setting would be a real achievement.
So you're suggesting that any extra money is there and it can be achieved through efficiencies in the delivery of local government services rather than...
I'm saying that if you combine community health and social care, forgetting acute sector for a moment, then and you run that as one team of people addressing the needs of a local community, there should be some efficiencies and emerging from that. How do you do that? We haven't seen the plans for that yet, but at the moment in our community health and care partnerships, our CHCPs, which are already integrated, that work does already take place. And I think that work will continue to take place under integration. But it's right, I think, to look at the needs of the population across the piece and to look at integrating that pathway and the needs and the demand on that pathway and making sure that we've got some cross-system perspective on the thing.
The local government representatives are saying we need the efficiencies that we're creating now just to maintain the services, because our budget, is unlike the health service, is not protected.
I'm not disagreeing. Disagreeing with you. I think we're all colleagues around the table will have the same view. I'm sure that we're all under financial constraints. It's a challenging time for us. There is austerity across the UK. It affects councils. It affects health boards. And I accept. You're right that councils seem to have taken a larger brunt of it in percentage terms, but there's no doubt that we're all under financial constraint, and I've tried to describe some of the future issues that we have. I can't get away from that. That's just the economic reality of the world we're in.
Just to supplement to what Paul was saying, I think the important thing for me in terms of that integration, that is a strategic plan. We need the plan. And the coming together of the health and social care initially gives us a great opportunity to put that plan together. There's certainly things we can do almost immediately around better integration of services, not just between health and social care, but between our primary and secondary care services. There's no doubt that we can make some really early roads in terms of efficiencies and benefits, but I think we need to bring the plan together. And that plan will take a bit of time to put together, but it will set out for us the journey about how you make that transformation in the way we deliver services that does potentially release capacity from the acute hospitals. But currently that plan doesn't exist in a form that would give us confidence that resource can be released very quickly. I think over time there's no doubt that we have to invest differently and look at the reconfiguration of services, possibly with more in the community. But we need to do that together. And I think for me, the integration bit is about, actually, this is a great opportunity to come together, to jointly plan. We both face very difficult financial circumstances. We've always predicted that as we went towards 15, 16, 16, 17, we'd all start to feel it very difficult. And for health, we will feel it very difficult in these 2 years. But that doesn't mean we've got to stop. And I think the integration agenda is about coming together, having a mutual understanding of each other's position, but a real focus in actually making integration happen and supporting the people on the ground, the delivering services, who want some help in terms of just bringing things together. And I think there's a lot of progress we can make without necessarily shifting resource, but by better integration. That's the theme for me, is about how do we bring the integration agenda together and then look long-term about how you change the configuration of services and the way the resource is then deployed. That would be my thoughts in terms of what health and social care integration offers, both immediate and long-term.
Add?
Nothing really to add. Right. It's just, I think health social care integration is an opportunity, and we're just really maybe at the start of that.
Richard, do you want to quickly?
Yeah, two things. I mean, there are 837 beds today blocked, if you like, by delayed discharges. And the number of bed days occupied are something like a third of a million. I mean, these are big figures, and yet the council budgets are, as you said, under greater stress because they've had no protection, no increase. And they're expected to take that up with the new targets of 4 weeks and 2 weeks, which are coming in. I mean, I just fail to see, really. I should declare an interest. My wife is in charge of health and social care in a council, and she just doesn't see how then heaven's name, with a cutting budget, they can actually begin to deal with that, although Stirling has dealt with it. I want to ask a question really about the use of planning tools in relation to joint health and social care integration. Since 2009, we've had the integrated resources framework. I'm quite surprised that's not publicly known, that's not widely known, because it allows you to do benchmarking. How much are you spending on care homes? How much are you spending on GP prescribing, hospital prescribing? How much are you spending on your readmissions? You know, what's your rate of the SPARA data, etc. I mean, it is a fairly simple framework that each of the community health and social care partnerships for each local authority have to have available if you're going to plan. And yet, do they all have them? Have each of the Glasgow CHSCPs or that are about to come into being, or the shadow ones, have they got that data? Does each of the boards give that data? Because it's the data that comes to the board, not to the council. And is it a tool that's useful?
Yes, and just to answer for Glasgow, I mean, yes, they all have access to that data. I do think there's work to be done on developing the data and to understand useful benchmarks, particularly on community health activity, because I think we tend to have more useful benchmarking on the acute side than we do on the community side. So I think, yes, they have access to the data, but I think there is room for improvement in the data as we move forward with integration. And I think that's something that are they called information systems? Directorate? I'm not sure. ISD, sorry. ISD, yes. Are fully aware of and are trying to develop that database so that we do get more meaningful information to support planning.
I think the ISD is a great start. I think we've got some follow-up to do to give us confidence in terms. It's at a very high level. It's very helpful in terms it allows us to look at spend, for instance, by GP practice in terms of various services. So I think it's a useful start point. It's great. I think we need to start to use it. I think that's a key thing. We've really not used it together. And I think as we come together with the joint strategic plans, which we'll need to have in place as we start off with the new integration arrangements, that has to be part of the information that informs actually where we might make changes or potentially could make changes, and then how that would be transacted through a service change process.
The situation in borders, yes, we do have an integrated IRF model, which is actually run by a joint post between the local authority and myself, and both organisations have access to that data. We have been working to improve the quality of that data, particularly around about some of the community information in it. To date, we have used it, information sharing across both organisations. It's also been used as part of some of the change fund projects. It's currently coming into its fore, particularly around about the strategic plan that we're writing jointly as part of health and social integration. So it's something we've developed. There's more to do, but certainly we're picking that up as we go forward on the integration agenda.
I would just add to what Carol said. We in Orkney, we obviously only have one partnership, so the data is available. But similar to Carol, we've used some of the change fund money over the last 3 years, where we actually have a post which is dedicated to the partnership, who is responsible for actually collecting and validating the data, both council and health data. So I would recognise and appreciate that we've got further to go, but we are using the data that is available for planning purposes, and that will underpin the strategic plan, which I totally agree with Alan is key over the summer months to develop in terms of how we move forward in this agenda.
One final one in terms of a view on the, we've got Glasgow, Clyde and Grampian here, on the NRAC formula, about the robustness of that model and the assessments that were made, and I suppose the balance of need. Is there any comments on that? Alan Gray, I think, is tempted.
I guess we've accepted then that formula is that the current basis for allocating resource within the health system in Scotland is a population base adjusted for, you know, morbidity of life circumstances. So it's a model I guess we have accepted. I guess the position in Grampian we find is that we're probably the board furthest away from NRAC parity. Albeit we've now agreed a three-year plan that over the next 3 years we'll move towards to be within 1% of parity by 2016-17, assuming our population doesn't continue to rise. So we find ourselves at the beginning of this year £35 million under NRAC parity. The double challenge we face in Grampian, of course, is that even when we get to parity, because of the healthy state of our population, if you like, we don't get funded. So the population, I think, in Grampian is something like 10.7% of the population of Scotland. But when we're at NRAC parity, we'll get 9.7% of the resource. So even once we reach parity, Grampian's overall allocation is less than a percentage of the population, because it's adjusted for the, you know, the various morbidity life circumstances of the Grampian population. So the NRAC formula we have accepted, we're working very closely in terms of the plan over the next 3 years. We've at least now got certainty around the NRAC additional monies we'll get over the next 3 years. That does present a challenge for the board and Grampian in terms of actually how we continue to manage all the requirements of service delivery, but with a resource that is less than the NRAC sum that we're, I guess, entitled to under the formula. So that's the challenge we face. And it's a significant challenge every year, because it does mean we have difficult choices to make about what we can do and we cannot do. And the level of efficiencies we've had to achieve have probably been higher than most boards in Scotland because of that relative funding position.
Is the balance between the population and need the correct one? Or?
It's a difficult, I don't know, it's a difficult one to answer. Is a healthier population, do they require less health? I'm not sure. One could argue that, you know, they've probably similar demands or different demands depending on, you know, for instance, we're back to cancer services, you know, the healthy state of our population means that, you know, they can probably go through fairly aggressive forms of cancer treatment. So our ability of our population to access, also, the, you know, a more middle class population also can access services in a different way. So I'm not sure the need and is this linked around the NRAC morbidity life circumstances calculation. I'm not sure there's any less need for us than any other board in Scotland, but that's the situation we have to work within. So the NRAC form is, we've agreed to that, we're working with that, and the formula itself can be adjusted. And remember, the formula is subject to regular review, so it's not a static formula. It's fixed. There is subject to review and refinement, and that has had some benefits to Grampian over that piece in terms of there was a remote and rural factor added in. And that was advantageous to us, it recognised, within Grampian and within some of the more rural boards. There was a higher cost linked to the remote and rural working. So the NRAC formula has some flexibility. I'm part of the group that reviews that on a regular basis. So I'd have to say that we do work with that formula. It has the potential to be adjusted over time to reflect changes.
It's an ongoing process? Or?
It's an ongoing process. I mean, the formula is rerun. Then, of course, then to get to parity, the position is you can't then suddenly move to the position.
We've heard this morning from Mr. James that 40% of those with Hep C are in the board area. I presume that we could predict that they'll have a significant number, majority of the cancers in Scotland, the majority of strokes in Scotland, the majority of... do you feel that meets the needs of Glasgow Clyde as it's currently structured?
I think the group that Alan refers to is the Technical Advisory Group for Resource Allocation. It meets, I sit on it, others do too, and it is indeed a dynamic formula. It is rerun occasionally. The major influence on the formula is population. And so if population is wrong, then the formula comes out with, you know, a different answer. Population is based on the census. The census mid-year estimates are updated by NRS. And we found after the last census that there was a significant shift from the previous mid-year estimate of the previous census and the 2011 census itself. As a result of that, the notional allocations for funding for boards changed. Ours changed by about 20 million. I don't know the figures for the other boards, but they all changed. Lothian changed quite significantly. So this distance from parity, i.e. the amount of funding that we get compared to this notional allocation that comes out of the NRAC formula, shifted because of the census. So you can always criticise a population-based formula because it relies on population figures at its heart. And if those population figures shift, then clearly the funding that we would all expect to get shifts. So I think it suffers from that flaw, but, you know, can you think of a better model? And you have to find some way of funding the boards. So I think that there's sort of a level of acceptance of the thing. Does it reflect things like the risk share that you've just referred to that I mentioned earlier, sofosbuvir? No, it's not. I don't think it's responsive enough to do that quickly enough. You know, when a new drug comes out, the funding plans for boards are normally published fairly well in advance, and you can normally predict where you are and you know where you stand. It's not going to respond quickly. So we need to find other mechanisms to deal with those sorts of issues. And for me, therefore, a risk-sharing arrangement that the chief executives of the health board sign up to in that particular example is, for me, the right approach to deal with that. So you have your funding, but then you say, well, here's my 25% share of that funding, but actually I've got 40% of the cost of that particular thing. Let's share out that other 15% surplus amongst you. So I think you have to have a combination of funding mechanisms. Some are a bit long-term, like NRAC, and some are more short-term, that deal with things like the risk share requirements. Do things like the age-sex distribution work? I think that probably does work reasonably well, because I'm assuming it's based on known population numbers. But do the excess cost of supply adjustments and the morbidity and life circumstances adjustments, which are the other two adjustments, work well? I think probably you would say excess cost of supply should pick up the sofosbuvir thing. So, you know, again, it's longer term. It doesn't pick up sofosbuvir. So I think it's good for what it does. You'll never get it dead right. And arguing over to the nearest penny is got to be a mistake on a funding formula, I think. But we need alternative mechanisms, I would say, to deal with those sorts of risk share type problems.
I think thank you very much for the time you've given us this morning and engaging with the committee. We appreciate your attendance here today, and once again, thanks very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
We bring this session to an end while we await the minister. We now reconvene and move to agenda item three, which is the committee's inquiry into teenage pregnancy. Members will recall that the committee published its report in June last year and the Scottish Government response was received in September. Can I welcome Michael Matheson, Minister for Public Health, Felicity Song, National Coordinator, Sexual Health and HIV, Gareth Brown, Head of Blood, Organ Donation and Sexual Health Team, and I've got Gareth Brown as well here on my script, and as Gareth is at the back. Well, you're there if we call on you. and I've got Colin Spivey, Learning Directorate Team Leader at Scottish Government. Welcome to you all. Minister, you wish to make a short opening statement? Thank you for that.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome the committee's efforts to highlight teenage pregnancy as an area of further focus. I appreciate the recommendations that the committee has made within their wide-ranging report, and would like to see our dialogue in this area to continue. It's important that the committee are engaged in this work relating to teenage pregnancy that we're now taking forward across government, but most notably the Teenage Pregnancy and Young Parent Strategy. The data shows us that the rates of teenage pregnancy have reduced in all age groups over the last 4 years. As I mentioned when I gave evidence previously to the committee, it is a significant achievement, and I would like to pay tribute to those who have worked so tirelessly to support our young people and thus achieve such results. Some might say, therefore, why do we need a teenage pregnancy and young parent strategy? The improvements made in sexual health have had a major impact on unintended pregnancy amongst young people. This priority and investment will continue as part of our sexual health and bloodborne viruses framework. But as the committee rightly acknowledged, it is the wider determinants and interventions that we now need to turn our attention to in policy terms. A great deal of good work is already ongoing in this area, as made clear in the evidence submitted to the committee. So some of the work that we need to do will be to simply bring these elements of best practice together. This is true in policy terms as well as the work taking place across local government and NHS boards in the third sector. We are delighted that Professor John Frank of the Scottish Collaboration for Public Health Research and Policy has agreed to chair the strategy's steering group. His vast experience will be invaluable, particularly in looking at the wider determinants around teenage pregnancy and issues around health inequality. We intend that the strategy will focus on three key aims: to continue to reduce rates of teenage pregnancy, to respond to and support young women who become pregnant, and to support positive outcomes for young parents. We don't underestimate the breadth of work this represents. However, we are confident that those partners who are part of our steering group provide the range of expertise and enthusiasm that's needed in taking this forward effectively and positively. I'm more than happy to respond to any points the committee wants to raise.
Thank you, Minister. We now move to Bob Dorris for the first question.
Thank you, Convener. One of the things that struck me in doing our teenage pregnancy inquiry was a visit to one of the schools in Glasgow, whose name actually periodically escaped me. It was Smithycroft Secondary that we visited. And what a positive contribution the young mother's unit made there for the wider benefit of the whole school, actually, but also for the lives of the children and the mothers within the unit. The reason I mention that is twofold. Firstly, obviously, depending on where you are in the country, that kind of provision will or won't be available. So I'm just wondering if the Scottish Government's got a feeling how local authorities should take forward those kind of high-quality specialist units, as opposed to, I suppose, if you like, for lack of a better description, mainstreaming provision within secondary schools for teenage mums. But secondly, my experience is that some of the people who are best informed on how to take forward a relationship and sexual health strategy are young mothers themselves that have been through the process. My second question would be, sneaking two questions in there, convener, would be what role you think young mothers that have been through the life experience of falling pregnant and getting on with the job of being a mum but also being a teenager at the same time, what they would have to inform a sexual health and relationship strategy, Minister?
Okay. Like a number of the committee members, I visited Smithycroft in Glasgow, which supports young mums from across different parts of Glasgow, though it's based in the East End of Glasgow itself, and it was I was very impressed with the quality of work which they undertake and the intensity of the work that the programme undertakes with the young mums. The approach that we're taking, as we discussed at our last evidence session, is to look at how we can not only build on the work that we've done to reduce unintended pregnancies amongst teenagers, but also how we can also support the young parenting aspect for those young women who do become parents, because we know that they can experience certain barriers, etc., in accessing services, and what we can do to try and make sure that our COD and local authorities who are working with us in this area are doing that much more effectively. And Smithycroft is a very good model of an approach that can be taken. Part of developing the new strategy will be looking at how we can build on exactly the type of things that we can learn from Smithycroft and how that can be used in our local authority areas. What the although the steering group will decide on what will be in the actual strategy itself, what we're not intending to do is to propose one model that has to be applied across all local authority areas to allow that flexibility. There are key principles here around the services that should be made available, and that those principles should underpin the way in which services are designed at a local level. So the new strategy will intend to work on the good progress we've made around reducing unintended teenage pregnancies, but also look at what further measures should underpin the work that's taken forward at a local level between local authorities, our health boards and our third sector colleagues in helping to support young women who do become parents in supporting them. And we know there are certain factors around that. So, for example, one of the key aspects of Smithycroft was about maintaining young women in education, because there had been a tendency for young women when they became pregnant, while they were still of school age, and dropping out of education. And there are consequences that then develop from that. And if we can make sure that we provide them with the right type of support at that particular point to make a positive choice and to go into a positive destination, that not only helps the young mother, but also it helps to improve the outcomes for the child as well. So it's not about one particular model, but that's one model that I think it highlights the very good principles that should underpin the way in which services can be delivered for young parents.
Minister, I agree with that. I'd written down flexibility and choice at a local level. And Smithycroft is obviously an excellent example of where a local authority has got the planning of the support services for teenage mothers right, and also that they're excellent at promoting positive parenting with the children there. But I had mentioned how the experiences of mothers that have been through that experience, how that could be fed into any refreshed strategy. I mean, we had a lot of talk previously about how, you know, relationship education in very early years, so in primary school, for example, and a variety of factors that then leads to people making informed or uninformed choices later in life. And the mothers we met love their children dearly, they're making a wonderful success of it. But it's also to learn from what maybe they thought did or didn't go wrong in terms of their experience, their wider experience, not just their educational, but the wider relationship experience that they had with maybe youth services locally and that kind of thing. So will there be a feed-in? I mean, if it's maybe something you're still thinking about, great, but do you think there will be a mechanism to feed in from those direct experiences of teenage mums?
Okay. The steering group that's been headed up by Professor Frank has a range of different individuals on it, including a representative from Smithycroft who's involved in the delivery of that service, to use some of their experience to feed directly into it. The steering group will determine
what's the best way for them to gather the evidence that they require, who they engage with. We're not prescribing that to them, but what we have put together is a very wide-ranging steering group to allow them to start that process. And that will take place over the coming months. I have no doubt that they will want to engage with young parents directly themselves. How they facilitate that would obviously be a matter for the steering group. Once the steering group have actually drafted their paper, there will then be a consultation exercise before any strategy is actually finalised as well, which again would give an opportunity for some individuals to be involved. And I'm more than happy from the government's perspective to look at, when we are consulting on the matter, how we can make sure that we build into that process an opportunity for young mums who have experienced some of these services to be able to comment on what's contained within the actual draft strategy. So we have some individuals, I say, from Smithycroft, an individual from the Smithycroft project who was involved in development of that project, involved in the actual steering group that will be taking for development of the new strategy.
Convener, I'll maybe come back in later on. Let's see my colleagues in for some questions first, yes, and come back in later.
Yes, thanks.
First of all, can I welcome John Frank's appointment? I think he's an excellent appointment. I'm sure he'll do a great job for the government and for Scotland on this issue. Minister, you'll know that one of the things I carp on about is benchmarking and variation. And in our report, we did talk about trying to explore two things. One was to have outcome data at local level. When I visited Oldham, on behalf of the committee, I was extremely impressed by the fact that the disaggregation of data down to individual schools actually set those schools a challenge. Some of them thought they were doing extremely well until they saw their data. And when they saw their data, they were horrified. And the pressure, both from the Parent Teachers Association and the governing boards of the schools, meant that they actually developed policies and were very responsive to the support they were getting locally. So my first question really is about the disaggregation of data and the local localization of target setting. I mean in terms of just even the outcome data of a teenage pregnancy or repeat pregnancies. Because again, Oldham was interesting because it was well below the average in England on the initial data. And the government minister actually went out to visit and caught the group together and said, look, you've got a big problem here. We need to see you moving towards the average. And they then, you know, explored how they could support them as an area, and they did. And Oldham moved up to the average, which for an area with considerable deprivation was exciting and developing. So my question really is, what are you doing about disaggregating data so as an individual school knows the challenges that they're facing over time? And the question of the local authorities or the new community health and social care partnerships having a challenge in terms of the outcome data of pregnancies and repeat pregnancies, but also the other things like long-acting contraception. There are a whole series of measures that Oldham had to measure themselves against.
So one of the aspects I think is important with the new strategy is that what that's taken forward in the new strategy is evidence-based, and data plays a very important part in establishing that as well. We are taking some work. I'll bring Felicity in maybe to explain a wee bit further on some of what we are doing around data. We are taking forward some work at this present time to look at how we can disaggregate the data down to a much more localised level and trying to manage some of the potential unintended consequences that can come from that when it gets right down to a school, just to make sure that issues around confidentiality are managed, etc., so that we can get much more focused in where we need to take action where there are particular issues. For example, there's also the important element of making sure that we then utilise that data effectively and that we learn from that experience in other areas. So, for example, in Lothian, they've been doing some work in looking at the history of young mums who were in school and looking at the amount of time that they had not been attending school. And there's a clear pattern there in terms of when someone's level of attendance at school drops to a certain point, is that there was a clear link, not you know, directly causal, but there was a clear link. Now, what we need to do is to make sure once we've established or we've identified that type of issue in data, is to then make sure that not only has that been acted upon in Lothian, but it's also been acted upon in Glasgow, in Dundee, in Fife and in other areas as well. So part of the work is to make sure that we not only get it down to that level, but how we then utilise that. And with the new strategy, I'm keen for it to be to have targets set within it at a national level that can then be utilised at a local level, but also that it's very outcome-focused. And I think access to data is extremely important in doing that. Felicity can maybe give you a wee bit further information on some of what we are doing around disaggregating the data.
Yeah. So one of the things that we're doing to make sure that our strategy is based on the right outcomes and being able to measure those right outcomes is a logic modelling process. And whereby you look at the outcomes you're working towards and what activities you might do to achieve those outcomes. Now, part of that process is to look at what data you would need to measure and to work out your progress against achieving those outcomes. So that's a piece of work that we're doing at the moment, and that's it's a really good piece of work because it gets all your stakeholders involved to talk about what you want to achieve, but also how you might measure it and what resources out there, what tools are out there that are available to measure that data. And it's also about saying, well, actually, there's a gap here, and we need to think about how we might go and look for the statistics or evidence that we need to be able to measure that gap. So you're not just measuring the things that you can measure, if you see what I mean. And part of that we'll also be looking at, once we've got those statistics and we know what we want to measure, is what level we can take that down to. As the Minister says, we do have to be careful about when data become disclosive and how we measure that process. But I know that some areas are already looking, for example, NHS Tayside and the local authorities that they work with are looking at data at school level and at community level, and they've found that an extremely effective way of looking at their local rates and outcomes and so on. So we'll be not only doing it through our modelling process, but also the experience of other areas that have been effective already in reducing local rates.
So it may be worthwhile actually making contact with Oldham and finding out how the individual schools coped with exactly the point that you were making about confidentiality and not wanting to create problems, but it did seem to work there. I don't know why it worked or how it worked, because I recognise the dangers you're talking about, but it may be worth doing that. I have another question, but I'll maybe wait to come back in later.
Can I just respond to that point? Yes. You, we're more than happy to take that particular point away. Alison Hadley, who was the expert involved in the strategy in England, is a member of the steering group. Which would, and I would imagine she would be involved in the Oldham work in some way, either directly or indirectly, so we can clearly flag that up to the steering group.
Just following on that about what we know, and causal factors and other things, and you referred, Minister, quite rightly to the progress that's been made and the figures that were reported after, you know, the committee's report, the ISD figures, which showed a significant drop in teenage pregnancy rate in the under 16 age group between 2009 and 2010. And it showed that the rate reduction was from 7.1% per 1,000 to 5.7% per 1,000. 616 pregnancies to 492. Now, that surpassed the national target, you know. So, what was it that happened in that period of time? Do we understand what happened in that period of time to show that dramatic reduction in, you know, the underage 16 group? You know, what lessons can we learn from that can be applied in going forward?
As I'm sure you appreciate, there's no single factor, a whole range of factors that have been taking place over a number of years, because the figures have been in a downward trend for the last 4+ years around teenage pregnancies. I think there's a number of factors that you could probably highlight. One is part of it will be around some of the education work that's been taking place around positive destinations for young people. Contraception advice and access to contraception as well. The type of advice and support that's available within schools as well, are all factors that contribute towards this. Trying to isolate one particular factor is probably not going to be possible, but these are all areas where there has been a much greater focus in this agenda, which I've got no doubt have played a part in the reductions that we've actually seen in these figures.
We recognise, and as a committee, we recognised the direction of travel over that years, but that is quite a significant drop in that period of time. You know, from 616 to 492, from 7% to around 5%. You know, there's something happened in that period of time. Yeah, has there been any work carried out to try and find out whether there was something that was significant going on at that period of time that would give us a drop like this? Or do we expect falls like this to continue? Do we expect a fall of, 100-odd next year or whatever? Is this the trend?
Yeah. There is a downward trend,
yes, but
there's been a step mark there from what you're referring to.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not aware of any specific work that's been undertaken to look at why there was a particular drop over the course of that year or so, other than it is part of that downward trend. But I think the sort of three areas that I've mentioned are probably all the main contributory factors. There is also an element where when you are coming from a slightly higher starting point is that you may see step changes like that with different policies being taken forward. Once you see a reduction, the challenge is sustaining that reduction as you go forward to get it as low as you would wish it to be. So there is an element where some of it is coming from a slightly higher point to going in a lower direction, which is the right direction we want it to go in, but I'm not able to pinpoint for you an exact particular issue.
I mean, that was between 2009-2010. Do we have any update figures that show that positive trend is continuing at that level?
The next set of figures come out at the end of June, 24th of June, which will give us an update on where we're at with that.
OK, thank you. Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Convener. I actually have two questions, Minister. Can I turn to a question that I know you've been considering, and you can maybe give me an answer in regard to Roman Catholic schools. The committee drew the Scottish Government's attention to the dispute between NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde and Glasgow Catholic Education Service. In response, the Scottish Government said that it would engage with SCES and the NHS Sexual Health Promotion Specialist Network to refresh the Education Circular 2/2001. Which governs the conduct of sexual education in schools following the enactment of the Same-Sex Marriage Bill. Can you update the committee on the outcome of this engagement? Has the dispute in Glasgow been resolved? And what progress has been made in refreshing the circular following the enactment of the Same-Sex Marriage Bill?
We have engaged with the Catholic Education Service, and we've also engaged with NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde on this matter. And there's been a revision of the guidance. However, the differences remain between the Catholic Education Service and NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde at this particular point. So we've revised the situation. I'll bring Colin in maybe just to expand a bit further on the educational aspect of it. It may be, in my view, it may be that the views of some of the individuals within NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde will not get to the point of agreement with the Catholic Education Service on these matters, and sometimes these issues have to be respected, is that there's a difference of opinion between them in these matters. So it's not for me to force the Catholic Education Service to accept a particular viewpoint from NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde. There are some officials within NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde who believe certain things should be provided in Catholic schools, which the Catholic Education Service are not supportive of. But we have engaged and we have revised the guidance to try and address some of these issues. Colin, do you want to maybe mention a bit more?
Yes, thank you. Just to update you on the revision of the guidance, we did undertake a six-week
engagement with stakeholders on what was a draft of the guidance, and that guidance was available on the Scottish Government website and also sent out to two key stakeholders. We received approximately 60 responses from national organisations on the draft guidance, and also about 10 individual responses as well. The main issue that came out of the consultation or the engagement exercise was around the parental right to withdraw children from specific sexual health lessons. And views were very much polarised on this between various organisations. The position that we're at the moment is on the basis of that engagement exercise and the comments on the draft, we are moving close to having a revised document which ministers will be considering shortly. The intention is that we will issue that guidance before the end of the school year. You referred to the specific issue of the Scottish Catholic Education Service and the Glasgow Health Board. As the Minister has said, unfortunately, it's not been possible to resolve those differences during the course of the engagement process, although we officials have met with both the Catholic Education Service and with the Health Board as part of the engagement process.
Along the same lines, sexual health and relationship education, the committee recommended that the Scottish Government should undertake a full review of the provision of sexual health and relationship education. But the Scottish Government rejected this call on the grounds that two reviews were carried out in 2008 and 2010. Response also stated that the review showed provision and training was patchy. Went on to say that the Scottish Government believed it was likely to be the case, but it did not believe a further review of provision would add to the evidence base. Your response highlighted it was a matter for local authorities, head teachers, to decide what was provided in schools and what training was provided to teachers. Are you aware of any improvements in this consistency and quality of the sexual health and relationship education, given the autonomy of local authorities in this matter? Will the delivery of this be variable, and what can be done to improve the consistency of what is actually being delivered?
Well, there hasn't been a review, there has been a revision of some of the guidance in the code of conduct for use within schools around this particular area. Which has been taken forward. There's also been an updating of the education material which is available to schools and for teachers' use as well in this particular area. And the intention is that the code of conduct is there to help to support a greater consistency of approach and how this education is taken forward in schools. Again, Colin will be able to maybe give you a bit more detail on how we've taken that forward in practical terms. But given that there were two reviews in the fairly recent past, it felt that a full review wouldn't be appropriate at this particular point. But the revision of the code of conduct and the guidance should help us in addressing some of the inconsistencies that do exist there. And the new material, which has also been provided as well, should allow us to make sure that staff within schools have the necessary material in order to take forward relationship and sexual health education. And Colin, do you want to mention a bit about the actual process that was gone through and looking at this?
Okay, thank you. Yes, I think a number of points there that I would refer to. As the Minister has referred to, the code around the conduct of relationships, sexual health and parenthood education is in the process of being revised, and we're very near to the conclusion of that exercise. One of the things that has become clear through the engagement process is that there are concerns out there around the consistency. There are still concerns around the consistency of what is being delivered. And that is in line with the messages that we had from the 2008 and 2010 review, and we recognise that there is a need to do something about that. We believe that the revised code will be the jumping off point for us to be able to kind of relaunch something on that facet of the curriculum. In particular, when the revised code is launched, it will be launched in conjunction with a packaging of the materials that are currently available. Education Scotland will be doing a kind of pulling those together into a coherent package and doing a joint launch at the same time as the launch of the code. They're also looking at holding, Education Scotland are looking at holding an event at the start of the next school year, specifically focusing on this. In broader terms, there is a representation from learning on the strategy group, which has been referred to earlier, and we would expect that the strategy to consider the issue of educational materials as well as one of the kind of key things that might impact on this area. Also worth mentioning that since those reviews in 2008 and 2010, we've had the introduction of curriculum for excellence, and also the health materials, the sexual health relationships and education materials, have been revised as well and are out there.
Thank you.
Seems very busy, and you haven't been around since 2008 in the job you're currently doing, so it's not a personal attack on you, but that sounds very busy. And the question that Richard Lyle asked there was not disappointment for the committee, because I view it as agreement with the committee, because the committee found in 2013 that the educational experience and the involvement was patchy. The Scottish Government then was in 2010 carried out a review and found it was patchy. And it found it was patchy in 2008. So we don't need another review, and because we're all agreed that the delivery has been patchy. Why has it taken since 2008 and the committee inquiry on teenage pregnancy to get to 2013, and we're all agreed that the delivery of this service for young people throughout Scotland is not as we would want it?
There were two different reviews. The review in 2008 was for secondary school provision, and the 2010 review was for primary school provision. So they were dealing with two different parts of the education.
Yeah. I can understand that maybe in your brief, but Mr. Spivak said on both these occasions, and indeed the response from the Scottish Government in September 2013, agreed with the committee. We don't need any more reviews, the government response said. We know that we can't add to the knowledge here because we know it's patchy. There's no disagreement here, and there's no hiding in one review against another review, because that was the response. We've got a review in 2008, 2010, committee report in 2013. We all agree it's not good enough. Why is it taken since 2008?
I can't obviously comment about what happened in 2008. I wasn't in a position on that. I don't know if Colin was in a position. He was involved in that process, and he can maybe comment what happened at that particular point.
I can't comment on what happened in 2008. What I can say is that over that period, 2008, 2010, up to the current time, there has been. It's not as if nothing has happened on this issue. There's been a number of things that have happened. I referred to the review of the health resources around education. There's been the introduction of curriculum for excellence, and I think that is a key and important element here, in the sense that one of the things that I know this committee had concerns about was the kind of relationships versus biology question, in terms of what should come first, and curriculum for excellence very much placed relationships as being the important thing in this area of education. So there has been progress, and things have happened over the time, and obviously reflected partly in the reduction in figures that that have been referred to. However, it's quite right that we should continue to listen to stakeholders, and we have done through the engagement exercise around the review of the guidance. And they're telling us that it's still patchy. This committee is telling us it's still patchy, and I've kind of indicated that what we are intending to do as the next steps around that.
Before any of that impacts those young people and those that education process, you know, it's a launch in 2015.
Sorry,
you've had the committee review and the response in 2013. We're working through the situation. We've had weeks and months talking to, you know, various people. We're bringing various groups together. But we expected to launch a more coordinated report next year, did you say?
Sorry, the guidance is being launched at the end of this school year. So it'll be launched by the end of June 2014.
This year. So, this year.
Right, sorry,
you may be referring to the strategy, which will be launched next year.
Right.
And it's also worth saying that the strategy will be considering this area as well, and what aspects within the strategy should help to reinforce the aspect around education. So it's a strategy in 2015.
The other area where there wasn't as much agreement was the involvement of young people themselves, because at the heart of this, and Richard Lyle's question was, what is the experience of this educationally, and what support is there, biology versus sex education, what's relevant? And there was a call from the committee to actually involve younger people, get their views on that, because their views, as they were given to us, maybe it was forever thus, but wasn't a great experience. And the Scottish Government, I don't think, were as in full agreement with that. They seem to be qualifying how we would involve young people themselves and the type of services and education that they feel is relevant at this point in time.
I think there may be a difference of views here, because at committee, I think I suggested the possibility of if the committee felt it would be useful at possibly auditing young people's views on how sexual health services and relationship services are offered in schools. And as a government, we're looking at how that can be taken forward in order to harness young people's views. So we're very much with you in this matter, Ran.
Referring to the written response to the committee's report, which was maybe less than enthusiastic, we may have moved on with you, Minister, about how we would go about this. But
auditing young people's views, which the committee seemed quite supportive of. How would you mechanically do that?
Yeah.
I would imagine that we would probably work with a third sector organisation to take that work forward for us, and to work with young people to through a questionnaire programme and an interview programme to get their opinions and their views, and to use that to then feed into how we then take forward policy. So,
when is this planned for?
That's a piece of work that we're taking forward just now to look at how we can develop that further. So, we're very much in favour of young people being able to inform and to guide our policy in this area, and to use their experience. And I think an audit is a good way of actually going about doing that, finding out from young people exactly what their views are of what happens in school, whether it works, what does work, what doesn't work, what would help to improve matters.
When will that information be available to the committee?
I don't think we have a time frame around when it will actually be available to the committee.
Has the work been commissioned yet?
No, it's not been commissioned yet, no.
Okay. Richard, no, it's not. Skill Patterson, followed by Bob.
Maybe if I go in a slightly different direction, Minister. I'm actually in favour of babies and pregnancy. That's where I'm coming from here. And it would be better just say, just in case the Daily Mail says I'm in favour of young people and children engaging in sex. That's not what I'm saying. Not at all. In fact, I think we should carefully and meaningfully educate children at all ages. That's my preference. But I was fairly taken on, I think the committee was fairly taken on with Harry Burns before we had taken any evidence. It was in another session entirely. And Sir Harry was explaining about the pilots on the farming as partnerships and how that was rolling out. And I wondered if you could tell us how you see the family nurse partnerships engaging and what impact it's having. That would be my first question, how it's impacting on young people after the pregnancy and after they have a child. We had the good fortune, this committee, to meet some young women, I'm guessing ages 16 to 18, who had a baby and had been supported. Unfortunately, there was no males there, which would have been interesting to hear what they had to say. So my first question is what impact it's had on the programme and how it's the family nurse partnership's been rolled out in this regard throughout Scotland. Is the second question.
Okay. Well, we obviously we've got a commitment to rolling out family nurse partnerships to all of our territorial boards. So far, family nurse partnerships are in place in 7 of our territorial boards. There's further rollout planned in another 2 of them, and following year there'll be a rollout in the other board areas. I think the end point we're hoping to is by 2015 is to have all of our boards providing family nurse partnerships. I like yourself, have met with staff involved in it, a range of parents that are involved in it in different parts of the country, and it struck me how valuable they've found it, given it is for a very specific group, but how valuable they've found the input. We're now, with some of the early family nurse partnerships, we're now at the point where parents have graduated from the programme, some of the evidence has been gathered from their individual experience to help to inform how some of the other family nurse partnerships in different health board areas can actually learn from their experience. So those that were actually ahead of the game in the family nurse partnerships, Tayside in particular, which was one of the first areas to family nurse partnership, have built up a considerable level of experience. And we can use that experience to help to inform the other board areas that are actually setting out and developing and having family nurse partnerships. So I think they're a very positive way of which we can work with young mums at a very early stage in their pregnancy and then through that 2-year period as well, to help to support them, not just for them as an individual mother and for their baby, but also to help to support them and their family and to look at what other support measures can assist them to help to, whether it go into education, whether it go into employment, whether it looking at other challenges that their family may be facing around housing, bringing together our services that can help to support them. The collective way in which the family nurse is able to work with them and to guide them. There is also a randomised trial taking place just now on family nurse partnerships in England, which is due to report at the end of this year. Which will be very interesting. And once we have seen the outcomes from that particular randomised trial, we'll consider how we should use that to help to evaluate the progress that we've made in Scotland as well, and whether there's further work that could be done here in Scotland around family nurse partnerships. So I think they've got a positive contribution to make. They're not the only model, but they've got a positive contribution to make. And from the parents that I've engaged with and the staff I've engaged with, there is a clear feeling that they have a real benefit to those who have engaged in the programme. It's also worth keeping in mind that the level of attainment within the engagement of family nurse partnerships is very good, in that we don't have lots of young mums and families dropping out of it. So remaining engaged is a key part of the programme and how effective it can actually be, and an experience in some of our health board areas has been very good in maintaining that.
There's a question in the back of that also, Minister. I think there's been views expressed that the provision of the health visiting service has been impacted negatively, in that to recruit nurses for the service itself has left a kind of a gap. So, you know, it's taken resources away by, you know, the provision of the family nurse partnerships. Wonder if you have any views on that, if you could, you know, maybe clarify it and do my mind at ease.
Well, a couple of things. One, in terms of the rollout within our health boards, is to try and manage that at a pace that doesn't allow that to try and avoid or minimise that from happening where it can. The other area we're looking at is considering who can be a family nurse within a family nurse partnership to see whether there's scope to extend that further from what has often been seen as being health visitors who have been attracted to it. So we're doing that just now to see if we can look at extending the range of individuals who could actually become a family nurse in a partnership as well. And we're in discussions with those who are involved in the family nurse partnerships around how that can be achieved. But an important part is the pace at which we actually roll out the programme to try and help to manage any change that can happen around staff who do choose to go in to become family nurses, to allow that to be managed within the health board's staffing levels for health visitors and other nurses.
Are you comfortable? Is there any worries in the background, that any concerns, or are you comfortable with the kind of shape that it's taking and the movement from one to the other? Is it leaving a draft behind, or is it under control? That's basically
I think there will always be there may always be an element of short-term challenges that can be created when you, if you have, for example, if you have a very experienced health visitor who chooses to become a family nurse, just recruiting another health visitor doesn't necessarily fill that gap because you're losing that experience as well. So there is always the potential for it to create some short-term challenges in areas, but I think it's about trying to manage the pace in a way that allows that to happen in a managed manner, rather than just saying, right, you've got to have your family nurse partnership by next month, irrespective as to the impact that may have on your health visiting capacity. So to try and do it in a managed way. I wouldn't be naive enough to think that, you know, if you have a health visitor of 20 years experience who chooses to move into a family nurse partnership and then expect to have that post filled by a health visitor who may be newly qualified, it's going to be difficult for that new person to fill that gap because you're losing 20 years experience as well. So it's trying to do it in a managed way to avoid causing any instability that could occur at a local level. But we're not. That's important for health boards to manage and to do that in a planned way, and that's why they're being rolled out over a number of years to allow it to happen in a planned way.
Okay, thanks for that.
Bob Dorris.
Thanks,
Convener. I want to return again to a little bit about sex education and relationship education in schools. Now, in some schools, particularly in secondary schools, that might be delivered by a pastoral support or a guidance teacher. Some schools will have every teacher will be a frontline guidance teacher. They will take on that pastoral responsibility. So there's a various skills mixes, particularly in secondary schools, in relation to the delivery, irrespective of what the guidelines are. And in primary schools, of course, it's the teacher that you get that's going to deliver that kind of relationship advice. Now, I want to focus on relationships again, because the ability of any educationalist who is exceptionally good at teaching physics or chemistry or history or whatever, maybe a different skills mix required them to teach relationship advice within school. So I appreciate the patchy nature sometimes of provision, but it's about driving up standards and capacity building with staff. Now, the way I would monitor that, I suppose, would be I would be asking Education Scotland to take a view on the quality of education within schools. Now, I'm not suggesting that every school in the country should immediately have the inspectorate in to inspect all these things. Of course not. But perhaps I'm just giving thought to areas where there's clusters and maybe higher prevalence of teenage pregnancies and pregnancy of young mothers of school age, that might just be an area where we just touch upon with Education Scotland when they're doing routine of inspections of schools in those areas, just to kind of, you know, just to get a flavour of the quality of the support that staff have been given to be able to give effective relationship advice. And I think this committee would agree it's relationship advice with the clinical and biological aspects of it as required to make informed decisions. I think we all agree on that. So it's your view on that would be helpful, but also your view on something else. And I think he says, as a former teacher, that maybe sometimes teachers get a hard time. Young people spend a variety of relationships in life, and the most positive ones are not always at school as well for some of them. And those most at risk of having unplanned pregnancy, those that are maybe disengaged from schools. And I think, again, that's about good quality youth provision. So in primary schools, yes, early intervention and good relationship building. But when you get to those most likely to have an unplanned pregnancy in secondary schools, they may not be engaging particularly extensively with the school and their wider network, but they may be engaging with good quality youth provision. So has the government given any thought about how, again, we can identify the areas where young people are most at risk of having an unplanned pregnancy and bolstering good quality youth provision in communities? That includes funding, of course, and how we monitor and map out some of that. So hopefully that's a helpful question, but certainly something as former teacher. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I'm sure it's not lost in the committee. It is called relationships, sexual health and parenthood education, and relationships being at the front of it for very specific purposes in terms of how education provision is made. I'll obviously bring Colin in to maybe mention some of the specifics, but we've highlighted one is about the materials that teachers have, also the guidance and the code of conduct for teachers as well, and being able to, in the provision of this area of education, is extremely important. There are those teachers who may be more given to this area of education than others. My view is it's more important to have good educators delivering it rather than forcing reluctant educations to deliver it because they just have to do it. So it's about how that's managed within an individual school setting and the leadership that's shown within a school and how that's taken forward are extremely important. So they're important elements on it. Can I pick up on the point you made, though, about, for example, youth work and in schools where there may be young people who may have disengaged from education being at greater risk, etc. And I think this goes back to a very important point that Richard Simpson raised, and that is about the use of data in this particular area. And part of the work that I mentioned earlier on about the disaggregation of data is whether we can get the data down to a level that allows us to much more effectively pinpoint there's an issue. There is an issue within that particular area because the rates are higher. What we then need to do is to look at what's happening in that particular area and what action then needs to be taken forward at a localised level. So if youth group work is one aspect of it, is it an issue around how education has been delivered within that particular school? Is it about, is it about how health and social work and other services are engaging as well? Are there measures that can then be taken? Once we have that level of detailed data, it allows us to then look at what's the best approach to try and address the issue so we can be much more focused on our approach. Some of that may be educational, maybe health, maybe getting third sector organisations involved. That would really be determined on the basis of what was happening in that particular area. Youth work could be part of it, a part of the solution, but allows us to get a much more tailored response where there are particular issues, and that's where we can then make sure what we're doing is evidence-based rather than just putting in something which we think might make a difference but we don't really know. And if we put something in, is that we're then in a position where we can effectively evaluate that and measure its impact. Is there a change over the next 2 to 3 years as a result of the actions that we've taken? It's that type of sustained input that will be necessary. And the point Richard made earlier on about getting data down to that level will be crucial in helping to support that type of work at a localised level. That will require a multi-agency response. It will require health, it will require local authority, third sector, and in some cases it may require national government response as well. So I think your point is well made, and I think the data will be key to helping to unlock where we need to take some of that concerted action and then to look at what that action should actually be. Colin's probably in a better place to give you some more detail around the type of things that are available for teachers and the work that's done with teachers specifically in delivering this within schools.
Yes, thank you. I think there's a number of things, again, I'll pick up on. The first one is that you mentioned the the appropriateness of perhaps, you know, certain teachers delivering parts of the curriculum. So I think you mentioned physics teachers or whatever who I understand that, but yes. I understand the point that you're making. I think one of the fundamental things about curriculum for excellence and why it is such a different huge step in terms of education is that under curriculum for excellence, health and well-being is a responsibility of everybody who is involved in learning. So be it the physics teacher, be it the guidance teacher, be it the catering staff in the school or the janitorial staff or whatever, they all have a responsibility for health and well-being. And delivering that, a key part is around relationships. And it's changing the mindset so that that is true and that works. That's one of the key things about delivering improvements in this area. But specifically to move on to the Education Scotland's role in this, which you mentioned, Education Scotland, as part of their inspection programme, consider or look at health and wellbeing and the delivery of health and wellbeing as one of the core things that they look at in each school inspection and one of the things that they report back on. Whether there's an opportunity to make a bit of a closer link is something that possibly we could pick up in the discussions around the strategy. I don't think Education Scotland are on the strategy group. So that's an interesting and useful suggestion to take forward. I suppose in terms of who delivers in schools, it is down to local authorities and to schools, and that's consistent with our general approach in terms of learning, and I wouldn't see us wanting to be prescriptive in terms of saying it should be a particular teacher with a particular responsibility for a particular area that delivers something. It is often down to who is most comfortable and who is best placed to deliver this type of education, and I think that's probably quite right.
Can I just thank Gil Paxton for raising the issue of health visitors? Minister, you remember in answer to a parliamentary question I submitted, you estimated that when we've rolled it out of 350 family nurse partnership appointments, half would be health visitors. I have to say to you, I've done an FOI to the health boards on the training of health visitors, and I am concerned that we aren't actually going to be replacing them, even with more inexperienced people, and I take your point very much that it's not a like-for-like replacement. Can I ask if you would, in the on that topic, if when the workforce plans come out in June, if you could update us on that, because I know that the health visitor training is a matter for the individual health boards, and I'm not convinced that they are actually looking at the replacement in a way that they should do. But my question, Chair, was actually a very, very short one, which is on contraception. And when we discussed the issue, we raised the issue of Uliprystal, the long-acting emergency contraception, and you indicated that you had a short-life expert working group looking at that, and they'd make the recommendation. And I wonder if you could just tell us where we are with that, because that is now 8 months since it was actually generally approved. So. Okay.
Just on the first point as well that Rachel Simpson raised, that the Cabinet Secretary has set up a nursing advisory group to look specifically at aspects around health visiting, and that's due to report in the near future, which should hopefully address some of the issues of concern that that Rachel Simpson's raised. But I do recognise the concern that he's raised and the importance of health visitors to this. Specifically on the issue around the medication that Rachel Simpson referred to, Health Scotland commissioned an expert group to look at this matter. They considered a number of different issues and they have since reported and were in discussions with the community pharmacy on that. It would be helpful, I'm more than happy to get a full detailed breakdown of the outcomes from that particular expert group and the recommendations which would allow the committee to consider it in more detail rather than just giving you a quick run through the key bullet points. But there is a draft national PGD being taken forward as part of the recommendations that came from that. But I'm more than happy to give you a much fuller and detailed breakdown on that if that would be useful.
Dennis, Robertson.
Thank you. And it's a very brief summary in relation to what Bob Doris was asking, and maybe an earlier point from Richard Sisson on the data. Minister, are we aware if there's a shifting trend in young people becoming sexually active? And if so, you know, do you know what that trend is? And is there a geographical difference?
There are some areas of research that have indicated that young people are being exposed to information at a much earlier stage than may have been the case in the past, largely through being able to access information much more readily than was available in the past. So there are there is research that does demonstrate that the children are being made aware of these things at a much earlier stage. There are particular areas in the country where we know there are issues around teenage pregnancies, and we know that from the present national statistics that we do gather, and some of the specific work that has been taken forward under the strategy at present has been focused in these particular areas. So we do know where there are particular areas, and getting the data down to an even further level will allow us to be much clearer in those individual areas where specifically are there issues that need to be addressed more effectively.
So you're suggesting that exposure in itself is actually impacting on young people becoming sexually active?
No.
So the question was about, do we know the age range of young people becoming sexually active?
I'm not aware, but Felicity may have, if she's aware of some specific research in this area.
We have some information from the Health Behaviours of School-Aged Children survey, which is an international survey, but for which we have a Scottish arm, that does give us some information on young people's sexual activity. And it's shown really, and I'd have to go away and get the specific figures, that that level of particularly young people under 16 hasn't changed notably for some time. But obviously it's very difficult to get specific information on young people's sexual activity, and it also depends what you actually mean when you're talking about sexual activity. So that data is quite difficult to come by, but we can look at other proxy measures which might give us that information. And as the Minister says, that's something that we can look at further, because there are some interesting data out there, particularly, as I said, from the Health Behaviours School-Aged Children survey, that can give us some useful information.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I don't think there's any further questions. Can I thank you, Minister, for your attendance in this session, along with your colleagues. We have sought, we need your final agreement, but we've sought behind your back that because we delayed your attendance here by about half an hour from the expected time, and the committee members have got pressures about other meetings that they've got to go at this time. We are suggesting, with your agreement, that we would not proceed with the next session and postpone that for another occasion quite soon, if that is agreeable to you, and we would end the meeting at this point.
Of course, more than happy.
Thank you very much. Thank you once again for your session this morning. It was very interesting. Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks, everybody.